Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to fabulous Las Vegas, Nevada for the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. What a venue it is to come to the City of Lights and Entertainment for what promises to be one of the most entertaining finals of recent years. We've got 18 of the very, very best here in the Thomas & Mack Center, and today they ride their Grand Prix to decide the starting order for all 18 coming forward to the Grand Prix Freestyle to Music here on Saturday from the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. Delighted to have you with us. My name's John Kyle. I'll be talking you through the 2 days of competition here. And of course, it's a joint finals together with the Longines FEI World Cup Jumping Finals. And they have their first competitive round tonight as well.
Sorry. Perfect, then you've got a commentator.
So, this is our start list for this afternoon's competition. We've got a number of competitors coming forward from around the world. The Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage is the only worldwide linked series in the sport that brings together those from the Pacific League, the Central European League, the North American League, the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Western European League, and also a number of those brought forward on the basis of extra starting places. And those are places that are allocated to those who've competed at enough World Cup legs in their league. They didn't get one of the qualifying spots, but they are high enough up the rankings to justify their participation here at the finals. And we have two from the North American League and two from the Western European League for that. But there is the title they're looking for. That is the trophy for today's Grand Prix. And we will have our first horse and rider in the ring here in the Thomas & Mack Center at 12:15. Before then, we're going to have a little bit of Las Vegas razzmatazz as we have our opening ceremony here in the Thomas & Mack Center. And today we've got a very exciting one. We start every day with the national anthem. And today it's going to be sung by Terry Fater, who was a runner-up on America. No, he was a winner of season two of America's Got Talent. And we also have How Could It Be Viva Las Vegas Without the King. Elvis will be in the house as part of our opening ceremony as well. And that's between 12 and 12:15. So, final warm-up underway there for some of our competitors. As I say, we've got Inessa Merkalova, who's going to go first. An extra starting place for Inessa, who, of course, competed on the Central European League. Terry Steggers and Axis TSF, they were unlucky to miss out on their place in the finals as a result of a disappointing performance at Setogenbosch, but again, were high enough up the rankings. They are world number 40 as a combination to be given an ESP. Fabienne Lutkemeyer, now we expected to see her here with D'Agostino, ranked very well up in the world. She instead rides one of her other Grand Prix horses, Key Vincent Dynamis, a horse we saw at Odense and Den Bosch, Setogenbosch on the Western European League. They come in third. Laura Graves and Verdad, world-ranked number 10 qualifiers from the North American League, and they were individually fifth at the Alltech FEI World Equestrian Games last summer. Then from the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Western European League, we've got Marlon Hamilton and Fleetwood for Sweden, Morgan Babinson Mestre and Painted Black for Spain. Now, that horse, he's 18 years old now. He was the only horse to misbehave in the horse inspection yesterday. Got loose and absolutely treated as if he was not even eight, maybe 18 months, let alone 18 years old. Paulinda Freiberg and Della Poniati are also representing the Western European League. Tatiana Dorofeva, Kartseva Upperville for Russia from the Central European League. Alneda Kirk-Thingard and Jojo AZ from the Western European League are from Denmark. Russia's Elena Sidneva and Romeo Starr from the Central European League. Michaela Gunderson and My Lady, who've been competing here in North America, they are a Danish combination, and they have an extra starting place. The defending champions then come. It is Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegro for Great Britain, the world number one and title defender in the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Series. Then it's Lars Petersen for Denmark with Mariette, an extra starting place for that North American-based Danish rider. Hans-Peter Minderhoud, Glocks Flirt from the Western European League. He finished sixth on the league. Isabel Werth and El Santo, two-time FEI World Cup champion, including winning once here in Las Vegas in 2007. Stefan Peters and Legolas for the United States of America, the leading score on the North American League this year. Then it's Edward Gall, Glocks Undercover. Edward, no stranger to riding the World Cup finals here at Las Vegas either. And last into the ring will be Jessica von Breda-Wendel and Yune BB, who finished second on the Western European League, eventually having held the lead for a very long time. So there, once again on your screen, our production team just rattled through the starting order for you there. As I say, we are on air already, of course, you're watching, you're listening. We have then the opening ceremony, the first opening ceremony for the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage and Longines FEI World Cup Jumping Finals here from the Thomas and Mack Center in Las Vegas. And that starts at midday, and we'll have our first horse and rider combination into the ring, Mr. X and Inessa Merkelova at 12:50.
Stay in the know with practical horsemen, and please visit us at New 712. The World of Dressage, there's only one magazine that's a must-read one that promo. Dressage Today.
Pedro Chibulka there, who ringmasters around the world. He'll be doing the final call forward of each of the competitors. It's a big old arena, this Thomas and Mack, and it is really starting to fill up. There's a huge buzz of excitement around having these finals back in North America, and the organizers have done a superb job marketing them. Looking at how many people are already taking their seats, ready for the first horse of 18 in the Grand Prix. So the trophy there and some great names on it. Anki von Grunsven, one of the most successful ever World Cup riders. Isabel Wirth in 2009 there. Stefan Peters for the United States of America. The last time the finals were here in Las Vegas, and the US taking center stage. Can they do it again? Well, one guy in a funny costume and Elvis. Matt Lewis, who is taking the place of Elvis this evening. Elvis himself not available, and going to be doing our opening ceremony. So the sense of expectation here in the Thomas and Mack Arena, absolutely palpable as people take their seats, ready for the opening ceremony. The first opening ceremony of a weekend of competition here that will decide the 2015 Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage and Longines FEI World Cup Jumping Champions.
Known around the globe for dressing the top stars on the red carpet, as well as representing the best of the luxury bridal, Remacra is delighted to be able to celebrate with you the Western European League and the dressage finals of this exciting competition. Long an admirer of your amazing city, she is thrilled to have these finals hosted right here in Las Vegas, the perfect American city. Glamorous, elegant, bold, for the sport she loves. So let's join Remacra in welcoming these elite competitors, watching them perform at the highest level, and celebrating what has been an amazing.
Just mentioning our title sponsors of the World Cup Dressage, the only worldwide link series in the sport. This is the fifth year of Remacra sponsorship of both the prestigious Western European League and the finals of the FEI World Cup Dressage Series. Of course, a name very well known in luxury bridling, also regularly on the red carpet during awards season as well. Remacher's partnership with this most glamorous and elegant of equestrian sports is, of course, very understandable. They had their first introduction to the sport. They were actually the sponsors of the three-day eventing world championships at the Alltech FEI World Equestrian Games in 2010, and have since 2010 also sponsored the FEI Best Athlete Award at the annual FEI Awards ceremony. And that has been won a number of times by dressage competitors, Adelinda Cornelissen, a former winner and a former World Cup champion, and Charlotte Dujardin, a former winner of the Remacher Best Athlete Award, as well as the Remacher FEI World Cup Dressage Series. Of course, the very first one went to Edward Galt. It was a joint award because Miss Acra also wanted to recognize the wonder horse that he had at the time, the great Totilus. Our judges today, judging at K, Hans Christian Mathiasen of Denmark, Stephen Clark of Great Britain, judges at E. At H, Agnete Fransen Jacobaeus of Sweden. At C, Francis Verbeek van Rui of the Netherlands. Maria Svenitsen of Australia. At M, at B, Germany's Peter Holler. And at F, Liselotte Fore of the United States of America. We also have a judges supervisory panel here in place at the finals, along with the seven judges. We're used, particularly on the Western European League, to five judges. But here we have seven for the finals and the judges supervisory panel. Linda Zhang of the United States of America, Uwe Mecklem of Germany, and Henk van Bergen of the Netherlands. Overall, you know, dressage is, it simply means training. And they're looking for a horse that is obedient, alert, active, and just responding to what the rider's asking. For the Grand Prix here today, we're riding a set test, the 2009 revised 2014, updated 2015 to be exact, test for Grand Prix, and it has 33 set movements, and it concentrates, of course, on the Grand Prix level movements. And in those, we're talking about one and two tempi changes, canter pirouettes, and of course, piaf passage at the very high level. And there's such a concentration on those movements that some of them have doubling coefficients. That is, the score that will be given out of 10 for their technical execution will be doubled then by the scorers. That's quite a brains trust there. The chairman of the FEI Dressage Committee, the discipline director, and Edward Galt, all having a chat down there. Also, at the end of the test then, as well as those marks out of 10 for the technical execution of each movement, there are what are known as collective marks. And those collective marks for the paces overall, the impulsion, which is the horse's desire to move forward, and then it's submission. And you might think, gosh, if you want the horse to move forward and then you're looking at submission, don't they counteract each other? Well, actually, in a well-balanced dressage horse, they come together perfectly, and that is why they're looked at concurrently. And the fourth collective mark that we'll see is the riders' score themselves for an overall mark for the whole test. But sport is about 15 minutes away because we go now into the opening ceremony for the 2015 Remacher FEI World Cup Dressage Finals here at the Thomas and Mack Center in Las Vegas, Nevada.
Some fun as well. But it is the tradition of any sporting event in the United States of America to begin with our anthem. So first, the flag, presented by a cowgirl, a horseback. This is Sid Cologne, and as all of you rise and remove cover, for the flag of the United States of America, the symbol of freedom across the globe. For our national anthem on this opening day, we turn to a singer, a comedian, and a celebrity impressionist. He is the voice of entertainment at the Mirage Hotel and Casino. This is Terry Fader.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Oh, yes, it is. Come on, everybody, let's hear it from Mr. Terry Fader. Performing at the Mirage. Great to have him with us. Now, I don't know how many of you are Las Vegas natives. I don't know how many of you have come from a different part of the world. But one thing I know is there is an American icon. There is a Las Vegas icon. And he has come to welcome all of you back to the city of neons and nylons. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the king of rock and roll.
Well, since my baby left me, I found a new place to dwell. Well, it's down at the end of the lonely street. It's Heartbreak Hotel. It's a little bit lonely, baby. Well, I was so lonely here. You made me so lonely, I could die. Oh, it's always crowded. You still can find some room for broken hearts. Lovers to cry their little room. So love you so lonely, baby. You make me so lonely. I love you so lonely, I could die.
Higher. There's a thousand pretty women waiting out there. there all live the devil may care. I'm just a devil with love and swear. Viva Las Vegas! Viva Las Vegas! Viva! Viva Las Vegas!
Ladies and gentlemen, how loud can you get for the king? Portrayed by Mr. Matt Lewis, an absolutely outstanding way to welcome all of you to this great city. And now, I can confirm that Elvis has left the building. Oh, does that put you all in a good mood? Seriously, folks, let me hear from you if you're in a good mood on a Thursday. You know, you just watched Elvis dance and sing, and here in just a moment, we're going to watch some of the world's greatest dressage horses perform their ballet. But the bottom line is, they didn't just show up here by accident. What did it take to get here? Take a look at our big screens for the road to the FEI World Cup.
So, here in the Thomas and Mack Centre, after that fantastic opening ceremony, our live audience being reminded of the road to the finals. Across all of those leagues, we've got representatives here of the North American League, the Central European League, and the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Western European League. 18 competitors in the only worldwide linked series in the sport coming together. And we'll have the first one at 12:50. And there's confirmation of the start list coming up. We're going to run in two blocks of nine. And we're going to see some of the very best in the world. There is no doubt that Las Vegas is going to play host to one of the most exciting finals. Every year's final is exciting, but this sport just seems to go from strength to strength. Edward Gal and Totilus perhaps just put it up on a pedestal, but those who've taken the torch on from them, Adelinda Cornelis and Parzival, Isabel Wirth, still at the very top of her game, Charlotte Dujardin, Helen Langer-Hahnenberg. It's such an exciting time in dressage, and now we're back in North America for the first time 6 years. And it was the United States of America that won here in 2009 in the form of Stefan Peters and Revelle. And Stefan is here again this year with Legolas. Of course, he rode at last year's All-Tech FEI World Equestrian Games. But we also have Laura Graves and Verdad, who were individually fifth at the World Equestrian Games, and they could really make a good showing here. And we have the defending champion, Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegro.
And of course, the taping of competition footage is prohibited. So we're set to get underway in just a couple of moments now.
There's still bright sunlight outside coming in from the final warm up. Down then, back indoors to the Thomas and Mack Center and through that final chute there under the International Equestrian Federation flag.
And Nico, if you would, can you introduce our judging panel to us?
Yes, I will indeed. And a great honor for me to be here with you, Charlotte. To be here in Vegas for the 2015 Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. Seven judges for the first time here in this arena, the Thomas Mack. We have seven judges at K. We have Hans Christian Mathiesen from Denmark. At E, Stephen Clark from Great Britain. At H,
so Inessa Merkelova and Mr. X, they're going to be our very first to go, riding this 33 prescribed movements in the FEI Grand Prix test.
the first of two competitions that make up the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. Inessa comes forward as an extra starting place out of the Central European League. She just missed out on the space. She was third on that league. And she's ridden at four World Equestrian Games, including the Alltech FEI World Equestrian Games in Normandy last summer with this horse, and they qualified through to the Grand Prix Special at those championships.
Our first is this afternoon's field of 18, Inessa Mirkurova and Mr. X.
So when the judge at sea rings that bell, obviously in this situation, because of the size of the Thomas and Mack Center's field of play, they're going to be inside the ring when they're given their bell, but they have 45 seconds to enter the ring, which is to enter at A and start their Grand Prix test. And that's available to the rider and the public as a visible countdown. So to start off the 2015 Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals, it is the Russian rider Inessa Mirkurova and Mr. X. Just a little bit resistant out of that first halt. We'll just have a look through the test as we start as well. We have an extended trot here early on. Again, it could just show a little bit more in terms of reach and extension. And one of the important aspects that the judges are looking for is transitions within the paces as well. All of the transitions are super important. But coming back, starting the extended counter and coming back up to it as well. Now, these half passes, they start off here coming over to the boards at B and then back over to the boards on the far side. And they're described as very steep. Changing the bend and showing and demonstrating that the horse can show the balance required and the bend required on both sides and just losing a little bit of balance. Now, this is a movement that they'd all like to see taken out of the test, which is probably why it's so good that it's in the test. But, you know, easy to show a lot of resistance, very difficult to get a good mark for the halt and rein back. Extended trot once again, and then that transition to passage at the end of the extended trot. And this is a nice passage from this horse. Mr. X, as I say, finished third on the Central European League very early in that PF. I mean, it should be on the centre line. This combination with 10th last year at the Lyon World Cup Finals. They scored 73.7 in the freestyle then. Fourth World Cup Finals for Inessa. So she's ridden also at four World Equestrian Games. Her World Equestrian Games career dates back to Rome in 1998. So the walk section of the test, we have this extended walk from P to H. We're looking for the horse to be kept in contact and to keep the rhythm and activity of the walk, but also to have the freedom to stretch the head and neck out and down. Transitioning then from H past C to M in the collected walk. And again, a direct upwards transition from walk to passage. And this is another iteration of what we saw at the other end of the ring. You turn into the ring, then PF. The PF is quite short in front. You can see the horse's front legs have come in underneath it. Shortening the base in that PF. So it could also do a touch more engagement behind as well. Combination ranked 34th in the world at the moment. And direct transition there from passage to canter. Again, quite a difficult movement. Of course, we're at the very top level of FEI dressage here. Nine two-tempies
a real test of balance and obedience, these tempi changes, and the judges have to mark them as a complete series. They have the talent, our seven judges, of course, to give each and every flying change they see an individual mark out of 10, but they must mark these as a series. The extended canto could have shown more, but that's a balancing act as well. You've got to ride the horse you've got on the day, and Alessa is going to make some real tactical choices. All of our riders have to make tactical choices about how their horses the canter zigzags, perhaps not completely equally balanced either side of the center line. So now the one tempis. So 15 one tempis. Again, could be just spread a little bit more evenly across that long diagonal. They were a little bit compressed in the middle. Now we're asking a lot of collection as we come into the canter pirouette. Canter pirouette left, and it's drifting quite a lot. What you're actually looking for is that inside hind to be planted as closely as possible around a single point. It became a little earthbound at the end of it. But there's, to balance what I say about the size of the canter pirouettes, it's nicely balanced. It's showing a consistent quality of the canter. This is the time to throw caution to the wind in this last extension. And Anessa, in comparison to the canter, shows a little bit more in that extension this time. So this is the final center line now coming up for Anessa Merkalova and Mr. X, 11-year-old Tricana bred horse owned and ridden by Anessa. If Passage, they'll come to the imaginary center point of the Arena X for their last Piaf. And there's also a movement given specifically out of 10 for the transitions Piaf Passage. Coming down to their final halt and salute. A really, really strong start for the Rimac RFEI World Cup Dressage Finals. It is Anessa Merkalova and Mr. X for Russia. Just listen to that audience, though. This is going to be some finals. I cannot wait for the Grand Prix Freestyle here on Saturday. I mean, it was a very good test to get us going, but that reaction, super. This is a crowd who are going to enjoy their weekend of sport here in the Thomas and Mack Center. So a look back at some of the highlights of Anessa's Grand Prix program here at the Rimac RFEI World Cup Finals. Here we see some of the Piaf, and again, look at those front legs. They're coming back in, they're quite close to the hinds and losing a little bit of balance there just as I'm speaking. But that's what's called shortening the base, and it's not what we're looking for. We're looking for that good engagement of the hindquarters, but that the front legs stay square underneath the horse, and also that it's all working rhythmically and we've got the right degree of elevation and cadence in all four limbs of the horse, as well as the overall picture, the position of the head and neck, the rider's position, all staying exactly. Here's the pirouette. Now, I will be complimentary about this because it was a nice canter pirouette. It stays very, very fluent. It's in a good rhythm, but it is just that bit big, and that's what the judges will mark down. Provisional score then, across the board, we've got our seven judges' score, but it's 71.357. Anessa Merkalova starts us off at a really good way. Our first score in the clubhouse is over 70%, 71.
Judge N, Maria Schminnerson, 71.6 from our Judge B, Pedro, 73.1 and a 72 from Nino 4. And the position at Emma Metal give them that provisional score of 71.357.
And we do remind all of you watching now
So Terry Steggers with us now, another one starting on an extra starting place. Terry, who is a regular competitor on the Rimac RFEI World Cup Dressage Western European League. This is her first finals with Axis TSF, Tricana bred horse. 16 years old Axis is now, by Sixtus. So Terry, just in her final warm-up, the paper records have been collected from each of the judges. So now our very next to go is Terry Steggers with Axis TSF from Finland. Great international representation at these finals. Terry and this horse competed at 4 Western European League shows, 5 in fact, and scored a 77.6 in the freestyle at Neumünster in northern Germany. She's based in Luxembourg and was in northern Germany for a long time. She went there to study for 2 months and stayed eventually for 16 years. Terry's got a really fun and energetic freestyle as well. She was disappointed with her performance at Sertogenbosch that left her off the automatic qualifying zone, but luckily ranked high enough in the world, 40th, and with the World Cup form to be given one of the FEI's extra starting places. This second half pass could just show a little bit more lateral work and coming to the halt and rein back. And of course, Kira Kirkland, the doyen of Finnish dressage, so much an inspiration to all of those who represent Finland at the very top level, as well as many other people around the world. An incredibly well-respected trainer. And you see those judges' marks coming in. They're on your screen as well. Scoring 7.5. Disappointing transition there into Passage, and that is annoying because it's the first impression the judges get of the Passage. This is bang on the center line, this Piaf, but just struggling to really settle into a nice rhythm, but getting the good diagonal pairs working. Just a step of walk in the upward transition to Passage as well. And of course, as I said, there is that separate mark for transitions, Piaf Passage. And that, you know, is tricky because they can lose marks in two areas there. Not the greatest quality of extended walk. A little bit lacking in rhythm. And it's just an overall picture of a little bit of tension in the collected walk. And remember, overall, we've got those collective marks at the end as well, one of which is for paces. So you only get 2 movements to show off your walk, but it probably is going to affect about 25% of your paces mark as well for collective. So you really do need a quality horse in all 4 paces. The Piaf, This is really struggling here a little bit, but the Piaf was early in terms of its position in the ring, never really settled. And there's a lot of swinging in the hindquarters there as Terry loses balance, just coming on to the upward transition to canter. And I think the judges have it about right. I mean, she's trailing off a point or two that she might normally expect. I think she'd expect more 7.5s than the odd 8, and at the moment she's getting mostly 7s. And there we've seen a Piaf mark there, movement 15 of the 33, getting a few 6.5s as well. But this is, you know, this is looking like a 70% test so far, if everything stays good for her in the canter. so pushes the throttles forward, could perhaps do so a little more. Extended canter, Terry Steggers, Axis TSF for Finland. So this canter zigzag. A lot of them will use that in their freestyle as well, because they have to show a canter half pass left and a canter half pass right as part of the prescribed freestyle movement. So a lot of them, having trained the horse to ride the zigzag, they utilize a variation of that in their freestyle. Just watching these one tempi changes. 15 of them need to be shown. Coming into this test of collection now, the canter pirouette. And these movements, they begin and end a little bit before you think, not only in the written rubric test sheet, but also when the judges are thinking about, for instance, in these pirouettes, the collection and balance before, during, and after the pirouette. That all comes into their thinking of what they will give for these canter pirouettes. Now, canter pirouettes are movements that have the doubling coefficient of scores as well. And it allows the Grand Prix test writers to compress it down. Instead of showing, for instance, four canter pirouettes, you show two, you show one each way to prove the horse's training and balance, and you double the coefficient score, because that's how important you feel the canter pirouette is at the Grand Prix level. A shame not to see her go a little bit more all out on that last extended trot. Back to collection now, Piaf and Passage on the centre line for Terry Steggers. You can see actually quite well on your screen there, and it's easy for me looking down pretty much over the centre line to see that the horse just drifted a little bit in that Piaf. But coming down to their final halt and salute, completing their test in their first Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. It's Terry Steggers, Axis TSF for Finland. So just come back here. This is the transition into Passage early on in the test, and just lost that little bit of balance. You can see there Terry just changing her position of her hands on the reins. And as I say, it was a shame. It was the first time the judges got to see Passage from this horse and rider combination, and you really want to wow them straight away with that important Grand Prix move. It's coming into the canter pirouette, I think. Oh, no, sorry. It's my apologies. It's the start of the zigzags.
This 2015 FEI World Cup Dressage Finals.
And again, there's one or two points where some of this half-pass work could just be a little more lateral, but, you know, this is a test that should score about 70%. Yeah, that's where Terry was trending throughout. And what's important is, while we're watching these replays, the judges are considering those collective marks for the paces overall. And Terry did struggle a little bit with the walk, remember, the impulsion, the submission, and the rider. So 71.357 was the score for our first in the ring, Inessa Merkelova and Mr. X.
Okay.
And we have the provisional score for Finland's Terry Steggers with Axis TSF.
So the score is in for Terry Steggers and Axis TSF representing Finland in these finals. It's just under 70%, 69.9. Second at the moment for the Finnish rider, starting here on a Federation extra starting place at these Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals.
Yeah.
as I say in Grand Prix, anything over 65%, you can go home very, very happy. So we are seeing real quality here. And here is quality. Fabien Lütkemeyer and Key Vincent Dinamis. Oldenburger bred horse owned by Gina Kapellman Lütkemeyer and ridden by Fabien Lütkemeyer. Now, we expected Fabi here on D'Agostino. She is, in fact, riding Key Vincent Dinamis, a horse we saw at Odense and Setogenbosch on the Remacher FEI World Cup Dressage Western European League. D'Agostino was the winner at Stuttgart and second at Lyon and would have given Fabi a real chance here, but she's instead chosen and elected to fly Key Vincent Dinamis across the Atlantic. It'd be a great experience for this horse, and you know, Key Vincent Dinamis, 16 years old. So the first representing one of the most successful dressage nations in the world, Germany. Fabien Lütkemeyer with Key Vincent Dinamis. Straight away, the halt not quite square and straight, so just losing points there. This horse, not Fabi's top horse, that's D'Agostino, horse with which she won team gold at both last year's World Championships in Normandy and the FEI European Dressage Championships at Herning in Denmark in 2013. Fabien, a former European Young Rider gold medalist, that's at the under 21 level in our sport. And of course, absolutely bred for the game is Fabien Lütkemeyer, Gina Kapellman Lütkemeyer, her mother, and Nadine Kapellman, Olympic gold medalist, her aunt. She's done a good job there of maintaining the same quality of trot in the two half passes through the transition at B. A second or two to just square up the halt. And what's interesting about the rein back is that it's actually not a walk pace, as you might. It's more closely related to the trot because they move backwards, horses mechanically, in diagonal pairs, which is the same as trot. So Fabien and Key Vincent Dinamis, they're ranked 67th in the world. The way the world dressage rankings work is as combinations. So Fabien ranked higher in the world with her better horse, D'Agostino. Just the top line there not entirely settled in the Piaf, so spoiling the overall picture. But both the Piaf and the Passage showing good elevation and cadence, you know, they are really getting off the ground. Not really taking the contact out and down in this extended walk. And perhaps some more engagement behind would improve the overall picture as well. And this collected walk just needs to march an awful lot more. It's a little sticky. And that transition there, that judges have their absolute hawk eye on her to make sure there's no trot steps in the upward transition to Piaf or to Passage. Looking at the Piaf now, just struggling with that transition out of that back into Passage. And just a little bit of a kickback, a double footing perhaps on the transition out. So they pick up the canter. And a big question early on in the canter work in this Grand Prix, they have their two tempi changes. very expressive throughout the horse. He has a lovely face to him, you know, the horse, the ears pricked forward, he looks very keen on him. He seems to just be a little bit stronger on the left as well, jumping a little bit bigger on the left. One of the top young German riders, Fabien Lütkemar, Kiewicz, Dynamis. They have to ride that change while still on the diagonal. And Fabien gets that exactly, coming now into the canter zigzags. So they have to ride five half passes either side of the center line. They have a flying change of leg at each change of the direction. And the half passes are six strides, except for the first one, which is three. There's a flying change also at the center line at the end. It's a lot to do for a single movement for a mark out of 10. And you'll be unsurprised to hear that it is with a doubling coefficient as well. So riding with one tempies now. Sevens and a seven and a half from the Judge at M for the five half passes. There are Judge at M today, Maria Svenesson from Australia. So got the 15-1 tempies now. It's time for the canter pirouette. Remember, the canter is a three-beat pace, and what the judges, they have a little bit of allowance for the quality of the canter in the canter pirouette, that it can break a little bit four-time, but what they're absolutely against is that it is becoming a complete four-time movement in the canter pirouette. But Kiewicz and Dynamis and Fabien Lütkemar doing a good job in those two pirouettes, and you can see that their overall score has gone up that little bit. They were trending at 70% just before the pirouettes, 70.5 now. So the final Piaf passage on the centre line. There's a lot of points available on this final centre line coming into the Piaf. The transitions are also giving their mark back into the passage, and also thinking about this halt. You don't want to throw away the marks on the halt, where the horse should stand attentive, engaged, motionless, straight and square. They didn't do it at the start, but they did it at the end. A great halt to finish their test. Fabien Lütkemar and Kiewicz Dynamis. It's going to score about 70%, but where will it go in our order at the moment? Inessa Merkelova out in front on 71.343. That is the target to beat as things stand.
World Equestrian Games in Lyon just last year.
So a very high quality test. What we have here is we have a high quality rider, perhaps with her second Grand Prix horse. So she's scoring about 70. She's scoring regularly over 80% with D'Agostino in freestyle. So that would be in excess of 75 in Grand Prix terms. And this is the early trot half passes. And what I said was Fabien did a great job of just showing the same quality of trot throughout the change of direction. And just having a look at this pirouette from another angle, we watched it down the center line initially. And you can see the horse just working really hard to stay around that inside hind leg, the one with the white sock, but just every so often it's a big jump and he's just got to replace himself. So, score for Fabien Lütkemar and Kiewicz Dynamis for Germany. It is 70.857, so good enough for second place at the moment for Germany.
And from the judge F, 73.5, and it'll give them now 70.857, taking second place if confirmed. I'd like to confirm the score for Russia for Inessa Merkelova. It's a slight change to 71.343.
Just adjusting the score for Inessa Merkalova. Confirmed score now 71.343. When we see the score, it's provisional. You might tune in later on to one of the websites and see the score slightly adjusted. It's because the paper record takes precedence, and when that comes in, it is added up. And sometimes there's a rounding error in the computer scribes, or they might just press the wrong button, and that is provisional. But the paper record signed by the judge, that's official. Let's stop talking about scores. Let's talk about this next competitor. Individually fifth at last summer's World Championships, scoring 82% in the freestyle. Second highest average score on the North American League this year, Laura Graves and Verdad. Ranked number 10 in the world. So the first of two for the United States of America here on home soil. It's Laura Graves and Verdad, the world number 10 ranked combination, individually fifth at last summer's World Championships in France. But a combination don't have a lot of international mileage. They don't have a lot of indoor mileage. And coming first of all, their first question is this extended trot. And at the moment, the overall picture is potentially a touch hurried. Winner of two World Cup qualifiers at Wellington in Florida. Starts these half passes now. These trot half passes, there's a great flow to it. Again, just losing perhaps a little bit of the lateral work of it, the parallel. Just catching a little bit of an eye of the trophy there by the marker at H. But look at these early marks, some eights in there, and you can see, and a nine from the judge at F. So the Halton Rain Mac there, so easy to lose marks on that. Be interesting to see what score comes in, but trending at 74.9. I mean, in terms of world ranking and background performance, this is by far the best combination we've seen so far here in the Thomas and Mac. Great passage, very, very expressive. Yeah, a little hesitant in Piaf. It's not as good quality as the passage just at the moment, but nicely on the spot. And, you know, there's 12 or 15 steps of Piaf called for on the spot, and mostly you'll see the riders just let the horses move a little bit forward, because it's better to sacrifice the accuracy element of the mark for the overall technical proficiency of the movement being performed. The walk section of the test. Extended walk now. Laura brings the horse back in to the collected walk. And now here we've got this direct upward transition to passage. And they're looking for the cadence and regularity, the suspension, the engagement of the hindquarters, and consistent and elastic contact and true self-carriage. And it's related movement there, the Piaf as well for Laura Graves. And another difficult transition there at the end of that Piaf passage section, the direct upward transition to canter. These tempi changes. Showing 9-2 tempis on this long diagonal. Again, as I was saying about the overall picture, the holistic element of the judging, the quality of the canter beginning and after the changes is as an important part of the mark that will be given by the seven judges around the ring. So Laura Graves and Verdad for the United States of America, just completing their long extended canter there. A
again, another one perhaps just with the zigzag a little bit balanced over towards the B side of the arena. In the last half pass, lacking in some quality. And we saw that earlier on the trot half passes, that she was losing the lateral and the parallel feeling to the half passes once or twice. Three of the judges giving some eights there. Just breaking for a second there, coming into that canter pirouette. And the reason we mentioned that she doesn't have an extensive amount of indoor experience is the atmosphere is just so, so different. I mean, it's bright sunlight out here. In here, it could be any time of the day or night. And the audience are close, but they're big. And they, in this Thomas and Mack Center, they go up high in the auditorium as well. There's a lot for a horse that is not being submissive and obedient to look around and to catch the eye. And we've saw, you know, somebody catching the eye of the trophy here in the corner of the arena as well. So this final center line, the real money line, it's got Piaf Passage on it. It's got a doubling coefficient for the last Piaf. It's got the extra mark for transition Piaf Passage. There is so much work to do. There are so many marks that could be lost here. But holding it together as she comes to her final halt and salute and potentially going into the lead is the US rider, Laura Graves and Verdun. The best of the US at last year's World Championships and currently ranked the world number 10 combination. There is the Remacher FEI World Cup trophy, dating back to 1986, when Danish rider took the very first one. Annegrethe Thornblad and Mart Zog. So looking, Laura Graves, some of the highlights from her test. She's playing to a friendly audience here in the Thomas and Mack Center, no doubt about that, but our seven judges are absolutely flag blind. They will just look at the horse and the rider and the movements and the technical precision. This was this first Piaf, which was a little bit disappointing from this combination, but you can just imagine the tension, the atmosphere, and maybe even the heat down there in the ring. It's quite well air-conditioned, this arena. It's comfortable enough up where I am, when you would imagine the body heat from the crowd coming up to me. But down in the ring, it really can be that hot atmosphere, both physically and mentally for the horses, but they're all dealing with it very well. Laura just there, maybe with a lifesaver or something for her horse. And with seven judges around the ring, and also that judges supervisory panel, we sometimes just have that little bit longer wait than we're used to, with five judges in Europe for the provisional scores. We just also have one adjustment. Terry Steggers, 69.871, confirmed score for Terry Steggers. We had the London 2012 Olympics. We talked a lot about, for the British competitors, home advantage. But of course, when you're working in a situation where you have an animal as part of your team, an independently minded animal, it's very easy for home support to turn home advantage into home disadvantage. Laura Graves and Verdad, they score 74.286 and take over the lead here in the Thomas and Mack Center in the Remacher FEI World Cup Dressage Finals Grand Prix. Now, interestingly, two judges, Judge at H and Judge at B, have Inessa by the merest margins, Inessa Merkelova as their highest score. But overall, Laura Graves leads when you average out the seven judges' scores.
Fleetwood is a Westphalian gelding. He's a 16-year-old, owned by Marlin.
Marlin Hamilton now in Fleetwood.
Marlin
and Fleetwood ranked well inside the world's top 100. They are number 83 in the world. And they qualify through from the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Western European League. And they picked up points at Gothenburg, Neumünster, Stockholm, and also at two Central European League shows at Sosnov in Poland and Tallinn in Estonia. So I was talking about the arena atmosphere. You can just imagine the buzz. You can probably hear a little bit of it in the background here after, you know, one of their own, the American Laura Graves, goes into the lead in the Grand Prix at the finals. So a tricky draw for Malin. Again, they are doing their final warm-up inside of the ring just because of the size of the field of play here in the Thomas and Mack. So our next to go is the Swedish rider Marlon Hamilton and Fleetwood. Fleetwood, a 16-year-old by the great dressage sire Floristan, owned and ridden by Marlon. Just a little wobble coming out of the halt there. Combination we saw at the Herning European Dressage Championships in Denmark in 2013. Had good results on the Central European League and then rode at three Western European League shows to finish 15th and taking one of the automatic qualifying slots. Best freestyle score was at Gothenburg in Sweden, 72.0% there. So that would translate perhaps to a 68-69 sort of usual Grand Prix score. Marlon just having to sit still there. I think she's quite tempted to make some adjustment during these steep half passes. And now time for the halt and rein back. So Marlon trending about where we would expect, between 68 and 69% for Grand Prix. Could have just held the halt for a while longer. Just proving the obedience and the establishment of that halt as its own movement prescribed in the test before you then go into the rein back. But again, the riders are making these tactical decisions based on the horse they have on the day. The horse's passage very big behind, the front legs just coming in underneath again. We talked about that earlier on, that shortening of the base. So in principle, in passage, the height of the raised forefoot, the toe, should be level with the middle of the cannon bone, the supporting foreleg, and the raised hind leg should come just above the fetlock joint of the supporting hind. That's the book definition, but every single horse is put together differently. Transitioning to collected walk. Collected walk could march more, and then there's that upward transition, maybe a stride or two of trot just coming in there in the transition up to passage. Probably better Piaf this time, but really just Marlon is letting it drift forward. She's not showing those 12 to 15 pretty much in the one spot, and maybe a step or two short there. I didn't quite have a count on it. And of course, that level of inaccuracy missing out on not showing as many as 12 or more than 15. You know, the judges have to mark that down. And it's one of the areas where the judges' supervisory panel will step in, because there are judges' guidelines for the maximum mark available in certain circumstances for each movement possible in dressage. So completing the two tempi changes there. Marlon Hamilton and Fleetwood for Sweden. Just really riding out for that extended canter. It's a nice extended canter. And that flying change, it's within the movement, and they have to show it on the diagonal before they rejoin the track at K, which Marlon did so, but she right at the last minute. It's a very well-placed canter, half-pass zigzag from Marlon Hamilton. You might be saying, you know, we're saying a lot of positive things about this horse and rider combination and not too many negatives. Why is this scoring 68? We said negative things about other people and they're scoring 74, 75. It's about the wow factor and the technical ability of the horse to deliver these moves. And it'll be interesting to see when you compare then the freestyle programs, a more athletic and obedient horse that truly has the Grand Prix style will be doing a much higher level freestyle, greater degree of difficulty, showing off more extreme moves with a more complicated floor plan. Whereas, you know, Marlon perhaps will show the prescribed movements, but without adding too much pizzazz to them. And that's where her freestyle is down around 70%. And we've got 90% for Charlotte Dujardin, our defending champion, for instance. But again, two nice canter pirouettes there. So the horse and rider here doing a good job. They're scoring the sevens. They are, you know, in excess of 65% in Grand Prix, which I always say is a great, great achievement at any level. Coming onto this final center line for Piaf Passage. You see there the judge at C, who's looking right down the center line, gives fives for both of those pirouettes. Everyone else then a mixture of sixes and 6.5s. So out of their last Piaf, coming through Passage to their final halt and salute. Perhaps competing with Terry Stegers on 69.871 for position. Completing their test, it is Marlon Hamilton for Sweden, Fleetwood. So a good example there of the Passage, and here's what we sometimes see. The Piaf is just, although it's very closely related, just not of the quality. And you can see actually on that angle, when it slowed down, we just saw the horse just move a degree or two off straight, down towards the A marker, and now straightening up and then coming back and passaging here as they meet the boards. So all those little things, the straightness, the overall quality of the test, but that straightness, the accuracy, the position of the rider, the quality of the underlying pace, all so, so important amongst the dozens of things the judges have to think about at every single moment during the test. Just watching this canter pirouette, and it's a good one, well planted as well when you look back at it from that angle, a flying change. Yeah, perhaps a really big jump with that inside hind there on the fifth or sixth step in that canter pirouette there the second time. As I say, down the center line there, see Francis Verbeek Van Rooy there actually in the pink jacket that we could see in the shot, giving fives for both of those pirouettes. So we stand by for Marlon's score. Laura Graves leading at the moment on 74.286.
Joining us now, six to go in this afternoon's Remember FEI World Cup Grand Prix. Representing Spain, this is Morgan Barbanson Mestre aboard the 18-year-old Dutch-bred stallion painted black.
So score in for Marlon Hamilton and Fleetwood, it's 68.029. It's pretty much on the money for normal form for this combination, and it goes into fifth at the moment.
With Fleetwood and a K, we have a 66.9 from E, 68.88, H giving a 68.6 from C, 66.7, M, 69.0 from B, 67.7. From the judges of 68.5, they have a provisional score of 68.029.
Well, our next to go, Morgan Barbanson Mestre and Painted Black for Spain. Morgan, already an Olympian, she rode at the London Olympics with this former Anki von Grunsven ride, Painted Black. Finished 10th on the Western European League this year and scored a personal best at Neumünster and then topped it in the freestyle at Zertogenbosch, the last leg of the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Western European League. Just a two-year-old Olympic rider, Morgan Barbanson Mestre and Painted Black. Ranked 26th in the world, this combination. Scored 78.9 in the freestyle at Zertogenbosch, which was a new personal best for them and helped propel them into an automatic qualifying spot for these finals. She was 15th in the Grand Prix freestyle at last summer's World Championships at the Alltech FEI World Equestrian Games. This 18-year-old horse, Painted Black, just absolutely springing along, brings in the collection then in the corner to produce this good half pass. Now a little bit of gamesmanship there because she met the boards well before B. Just taking a little adjustment in that second half pass to bring the horse back a little bit off the forehand. Nice square and secure halt and clear diagonal steps backwards. Transition into Passage out of that. The trot out of the rein back was perhaps a little bit, you know, too forward to really show a good difference then on the long diagonal. Quality Piaf Passage let the last few steps go forward, transitioning into Passage. And remember, in each circumstance, so three times during the test, they've got that separate mark for transitions Piaf Passage. Overall, perhaps you'd just like to have seen it a degree more static so that we saw a real difference between the paces. You're just looking for those V's forming in the legs in the extended walk to just show the engagement behind and the continuation of the quality of the walk. And now transitioning to collected walk. And that transition there is actually a movement on its own. Picking up Passage and the transition from collected walk to Passage are the only elements required for a full mark out of 10. Not quite straight coming out on the Passage there. Picking up the canter. quite careful in the way she approached that transition. So the first of the series changes, the tempi changes. 9-2 tempis required to be shown. Just giving you a little pat at the end of those. So the seventh one perhaps a little bit short. So one of the youngest competitors in the class, Morgan Barbathon-Mestre and Painted Black for Spain, popping their flying change there at the end of the extended canter, ready to come up the center line in zigzag. Yeah, those zigzags perhaps not well placed on the centre line. They finish down at about I, which is the imaginary marker on the centre line between R and S, the letters around the ring. If you're interested, the mnemonic I use for the 60 by 20 arena is "All King Victor Emmanuel's show horses can make really beautiful people fall." So centre line again, this time for the test of collection, the canter pirouettes. So the one tempi's there, pretty much eights, one judge giving 7.5, that's Maria Svenningsen of Australia, judging at M. This canter work between the two pirouettes, just lacking in a degree of quality. It's a touch on the forehand. Morgan could have just ridden it a bit more forward. So these are good scores coming in for Morgan at the moment. And Morgan would like to be on a 73-74 today, and with collective marks she probably should be, to come up against her sort of freestyle personal best, which was just under 79%. But this horse, for 18 years old, just looks absolutely superb. Now, let's look here for the difference, Passage to Piaf. Again, it's clearer, but if she could just hold it that touch more static, she'd increase the points. But a long way down the arena in Passage, bouncing her way to this final halt, and a beaming smile for Morgan Barbathon-Mestre and Painted Black as they complete their Grand Prix here at the RE/MAX for FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. So just looking back at some of the highlights, and this was a real highlight, the halt and rein back. Now, the rein back, although it is going backwards, it should not show resistance, and it's classified almost as a forward pace, because at any moment, you should be able as a rider to ask the horse to spring forward directly back, and that's what the test is. And Morgan Barbathon-Mestre and Painted Black did exactly that. And pointing back at the veteran, Painted Black, it really is a true partnership. So score for Morgan Barbathon-Mestre and Painted Black, it is 73.786. So second place, Laura Graves holds her lead, but just look at that little fist pump there from Morgan. She's done what she wanted to do today. For a lot of these competitors, it's not about competing against each other, it's about competing against your own best score, what you think your combination of horse and rider is capable of. So Morgan here, her journey is to take on, maybe score at the final 78.9, her freestyle personal best, maybe go better than it, and that will be a victory for her.
Our second rider this afternoon, representing Sweden, we welcome now Paulina Friberg and Di Lapognetti. 14-year-old Hanoverian mare, Di Lapognetti.
Paulina Friberg with us in the ring. The second we see for Sweden, also coming through from the Western European League. So here's our scores at the moment. Laura Graves leads for the United States of America. Morgan Barbenson-Mestre's provisional score goes into second. And our first from the ring, Ines Merkelova, holds third for Russia. Then it's Fabian Lütkemeyer, Germany, Terry Stegers for Finland, and on then to Marlon Hamilton and Fleetwood for Sweden. The first mare we see in the competition by Donna Hall, Hanoverian bred De Laponia T, owned and ridden by Paulina Friberg. Ranked 44th in the world at the moment as a combination. So next to go is for Sweden, qualifying through from the Western European League, Paulina Friberg and De Laponia T. Best result was fifth at Gothenburg, scoring a 76.9 on that occasion. We also saw this combination at Odense in Denmark, Stockholm in Sweden, Neumünster in Germany and Sertogenbosch in the Netherlands. So this first movement, the extended trot and long diagonal H to X to F. Paulina tells us in her bio that she's from quite a horsey family, but she was the only one interested in jumping and got bored of having to get off her horse constantly to put the fences back up or change the fences. So decided to stop fighting and concentrate on dressage. And to come through as a qualifier from the Western European League to the World Cup Finals just shows how much that concentration has paid off. Only second season in World Cup, they made their World Cup debut in the spring of 2014, in fact, at Gothenburg. But this is looking very polished and steady test so far in this big atmosphere. You'll be interested, the horses they flew across on a chartered flight from the Netherlands earlier on in the week. We've seen all bar one of our horses will have flown that transatlantic journey, and plenty of them scoring exactly what we would expect. So coming through it very, very well. So much experience in flying horses these days as well. There's a nice Piaf passage. Whilst I was banging on about flying, we did see a little bit of an error and a wobble in the rein back, so that will have cost them. But that was a good Piaf. It's one of the most in-place Piafs we've seen thus far in the competition. So just clawing in the marks at the moment, Paulina Friberg and De Laponia T. Morgan Barbenson-Mestre is on 73.7 in second place. Laura Graves for the United States of America leading on 74.286. But with good collectives, Paulina could go into second if she can hold her form at the moment. Of course, a long way to go in this Grand Prix test, including all of the canter work. Yeah, started that Piaf just before the centre line, and by the end of it had just crept to the other side of it, just the merest forward motion with each step of Piaf. And the passage has a really nice moment of suspension in it as well. It's a very attractive picture. And throwing down a strong gauntlet here. So coming to the two tempi changes. They're good, perhaps a little bit more flamboyance would get some marks, but technically very solid. Paulinda Freiberg de Laponia T for Sweden. Pushing out in that extended and then setting up for the flying change. This is very well ridden. So the series of canter half-pass zigzags, the beats to left and right. Belinda won the Swedish Tercentenary training bursary in 2013 to help her compete abroad. And she competes alongside work as a hairdresser at home in Sweden. The 15 one tempi changes, perhaps even a little better placed than the two tempis, where they probably just reached that little bit more and used up the whole diagonal. One or two times when perhaps lacking in straightness. And that canter pirouette, just looking out into the ring, I had my eye off the monitor. It didn't really appear to be anchored and planted around the inside line. The horse was more following its, allowing the hind end to follow the front leg around. But that right, pirouette to the right, much better, very nice. And again, a Grand Prix of 73-74%, which is entirely possible for Paulinda, puts us in the realm of her chasing down a personal best in the freestyle here on Saturday. So 60 meters long, this arena, and they have to passage most of the way down this center line, thinking all the time about straightness as well. The Piaf here over the center line, which has a doubling coefficient, and that is really gonna help Paulinda because her Piafs have been superb. So all those doubling coefficients really going to play into her hands. Last Piaf and building up towards the halt. Our second rider for Sweden in these finals here in Las Vegas is Paulinda Freiberg and De Laponia T. So looking back at some of the highlights of Paulinda's test, overall very, very solid, very polished, and really technically strong. Got a lot of sevens and deserved a lot of scores in excess of seven. This is the first of the canter pirouettes down at the far end of the ring at V. Actually, that reverse angle slightly belies what I saw looking over the shoulder of the judge at C, that it felt the horse's hindquarters were following around rather than really being planted. And this second one was a very strong attempt at the canter pirouette from Paulinda Freiberg and De Laponia T. But this Piaf, the third and final Piaf on the center line with the doubling coefficient, as strong as all the others from this combination. And we have the score for Paulinda up on the board there, getting a 72.6. Paulinda Freiberg de Laponia T score 72.686, so just into third place at the moment. Our leader, Laura Graves, for the United States of America, 74.286. Morgan Barbenthon-Mestre, 73.786 in second, and now 72%, 72.668, takes third for Paulinda Freiberg.
And joining us now, representing Russia, we welcome
Tatiana Dorofeeva and Kartsevo Upperville. They're our next combination to go, ranked just outside the world's top 100. They did finish second on the Central European League and thus came here as automatic qualifiers to the Remac FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. Scored just over 70%, 71% in fact, for second place at Moscow, and that's the freestyle score. And also saw them at Stockholm on the Western European League. They finished 14th there, 67.450. So what are we expecting for this combination from these seven judges? Maybe in the area of 63-64%. A combination that last rode the finals at Gothenburg in 2013, Tatiana Dorofeeva and Kartsevo Upperville for Russia. This Dutch warmblood, 14-year-old stallion by Cabochon, owned by Sonia Vavora and Natalie Bronikova. Big loose trot, could have gone deeper into that corner for the half pass, but again, a little bit of gamesmanship as well, just taking the sting a little bit out of these very steep half passes. Perhaps not showing enough crossing behind in some of these half pass movements. Just trailing one leg out in the halt. Not a bad rain back at all. Interesting to see the scores come in for this. So we're getting the scores we expect, sixes and halves and sevens. So starting the PF quite early, well in advance of A, just drifting across the center line. Touch more lift with the hind legs. The passage showing a degree of cadence and elevation over trot, but not a huge amount to set it completely apart. So just behind that South Point banner, you have one of the judges' positions as well. Right in this Thomas and Mack Centre with its small field of play for dressage. We had a nice shot down the boards there as well for that transition up to passage out of the walk. Big explosive transition there upwards into canter. And again, not a charge you would lay at the feet of these seven judges, but when you're judging or you know, just watching as we are, and a horse has that one white sock, it's so, so difficult not to have it catch the eye and create an optical illusion of things not being quite level or even. Just the hind legs nearly together in the last of those changes, so they'll lose out on the whole sequence. But this is a good trending score at the moment, 67.8. Tatiana Dorofeeva, Kartseva, Upperville for Russia. Yeah, they scored 67% in freestyle at Stockholm, and you always expect the freestyle to be a couple of percent higher than the Grand Prix score, because you have both the technical scores and the artistic side. And that zigzag, so we've seen one zigzag finish very short. That one finished right up close to the judge at C's table, used a lot of space in the ring. The one tempi change is just struggling a little bit for straightness. Judge at C giving it 4.5, otherwise a mixed bag of 5, 6s and a 6.5. Very close to breaking down that canter there in that second canter pirouette. So they pick up the trot. This last opportunity to show extended trot in the Grand Prix test. Tatiana Dorofeeva and Kartseva Upperville. Coming to the final center line. A few small mistakes, and indeed just the hindquarters out on the angle here, a little bit on three tracks. Initially on the center line. Again, just building up the quality of that Piaf as it went on a little bit. So a qualifier from the Central European League completing her test here. It is Tatiana Dorofeeva and Kartseva Upperville for Russia.
Just last year, this combination had a great finish in both Grand Prix and freestyle competitions.
So just looking back at the highlights here of Tatiana Dorofeeva, Kartseva Upperville for Russia. Just looking at this first Piaf Passage, and it wasn't the sharpest Piaf Passage. It improved as the test went on, but this is your first opportunity to say to the judges, I have absolutely got all of these Grand Prix moves squared away, me and my horse. And if you lose that opportunity, then you are fighting an uphill battle for those marks for the rest of the test.
She does hold the title of Master of Sport in Russia, and her father, Vitaly Dorofeev, was a member of the Soviet eventing team back in the days.
So standing by for the score for the Russian rider, Tatiana Dorofeeva, Kartseva Upperville. Just one more to go before the judging break here. Our ninth of 18, just coming in for her final warm-up.
Representing Denmark now, Agnete Gert-Dingort and Jojo AC.
Tatiana Dorofeeva, Kartseva Upperville score 67.043, provisionally putting them into eighth position. Countrywoman Anessa Merkelova holding fourth at the moment on 71.343. Alneda Kirk Thingard and Jojo AZ for Denmark. So our next to go, Alneda Kirk-Thingard and Jojo AZ. Ranked 35th in the world, and they have come back to the top level of the sport with a bang. Alneda was out of the sport for 8 years, having and raising her children. Came back fourth at the Danish Championships and then rode at a number of Western European League and Central European League qualifiers to end up seventh on the Remacher FEI World Cup Dressage Western European League. We saw this horse in 2013 in Denmark at the FEI European Dressage Championships with the Finnish rider Henri Rust. 78.05 was her freestyle score at Amsterdam for sixth position in January of this year. Jojo, 12-year-old gelding. Hungarian bred, interestingly, this one. Great square halt. A good positive rein back as well from Jojo AZ. Could show a little bit more. You know, a lot of people who see Grand Prix and they just go, oh yes, the medium trot was good. It's an extended trot on the test sheet and it must be ridden as an extended trot or you are hemorrhaging marks. And bringing those front legs in a little bit too much underneath for a truly great Piaf score. So the music that's being used here is not selected by the riders and is in fact being mixed live by a music producer, a specialist dressage music producer. They choose tracks that they think will suit the pace for the Grand Prix and then adjust them to the horse, and they live adjust them in the ring as well. It's a fascinating process and it really brings Grand Prix alive. Good marks there for the extended walk, just finishing up their collected walk. And a good upward transition there at M for that single movement, mark out of 10 for the upward transition at M. Now let's see this Piaf. Can the front legs just stay that little bit squarer underneath the shoulder? Looks better. Picking up the counterwork now, Alneda Kirk-Thingard. Yeah, mistake behind early on in these two tempies. You can pick it up on the microphone. They're just getting so close to the boards. They give them a little tap. So with us at the moment in the Thomas and Mack Centre, Danish rider Alneda Kirk-Thingard and Jojo AZ. This zigzag, sadly, not fault-free either for Alneda. And thinking about those collective marks, one of them being for the rider, and Alneda's position moving relatively early in comparison to when she needed to produce the movement for which she was moving her position, and that could count against it because it just takes the polish off all of that. Yeah, and those five half passes there, a mixture of fives, fives and a halves, and a six from the judge at M.
good and well planted. And the one Tempe's there getting low marks as well. I'm just wondering whether the judges' supervisory panel would have to step in on any scores for those one Tempe's, because if a judge misses an error, that's where the JSP steps in, amongst other circumstances. But all the judges seem to have been 100% alert. So last extension. Overall in the extensions, the horse's head and neck position, again, could just come a little bit up and forward. It's short in the neck. Right against Alneda's hand. Coming for the final centre line. Some good pirouette marks there. We're seeing some sevens. So 78% was the Amsterdam Grand Prix freestyle score. But for that, you know, you need to be 74-75% today to guarantee being up at that level. So a little bit off the pace of normal for Alneda Thingard and Jojo AZ. Alneda, whose family are the owners, amongst other things, of Lego. Coming out of the Piaf. A better Piaf Passage, perhaps, than we've seen before, and often the best marks coming in on the final centre line for Piaf Passage work for our Grand Prix competitors. Completing her test here at the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. It's the Danish rider, the first of three for Denmark, Alneda Kirk Thingard and Jojo AZ. So looking back at some of the highlights here from Alneda Kirk Thingard, our Danish rider. Have the Piaf Passage from this horse, and it was all good from Jojo AZ, this Hungarian bred horse. First World Cup season for Alneda in a while. She's had 8 years off the sport, absolutely come back with a bang. She's got a really, really enjoyable Grand Prix freestyle program as well. Great music. And that good transition there up to Passage. Such an important transition, because the full mark out of 10 is available just for that transition upwards at M. And a pat for Pony to complete the test as well. Alneda Kirk Thingard and Jojo AZ for Denmark. So score for Alneda Kirk Thingard and Jojo AZ. It's eighth position, 67.986. She put a smiling face on it at the end of her test, but when she looks back, she'll be disappointed by those couple of errors that have held her off her best potential. Can she bring it back on Saturday in the freestyle? So let's have a look at these standings. Laura Graves and Verdade at the halfway point. They lead for the United States of America ahead of Spanish rider Morgan Barbenthon-Mestre. Paulinda Freiberg is third. Inessa Merkelova, Fabienne Lutkemeyer, Terry Stegers, Marlon Hamilton and Alneda Kirk Thingard round out fourth to eighth. And look at all those flags. What an international competition we have here at the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. Just flipping over to the second sheet, it is Tatiana Dorofeva and Kartsevo Upperville who bring up the rear on 67.043. But as I say, any score in excess of 65% in Grand Prix in front of seven judges in an atmosphere like the Thomas and Mack Arena is a significant achievement. So looking back at some of our top performances, Laura Graves and Verdad for the United States of America. Not error-free, but a very strong performance for a combination that have limited international mileage and really limited indoor experience. The freestyle will actually be a little bit easier for these competitors because the music will have its fold back into the ring. It will create that element of familiarity for the competitors, and the horse, that independent-minded creature that's part of the team, will just go, ah, yes, I know this. This makes me feel more comfortable. I know this music. I've worked to it. Let's get on with this. So a very interesting prospect in store. We're halfway through the Grand Prix here at the Thomas and Mack Center in Las Vegas for the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. And our next competitor of nine will be with us very, very shortly. The time on the schedule is 10 to the hour. Do please stay with us. Thank you.
Hey guys, as you hang around for the next time, I want to call your attention to something that's going to happen on Saturday night. Okay? How many of y'all know Steve Verdot? How many of y'all know DZ Mack? How many of y'all know Lucy Davis? Well, guess what's going to happen Saturday night? They're going to try their hand at being Raiders and what were the reigning Cowboys. We're calling it the Duel in the Desert. We're going to ask your jumpers to ride a reigning cow horse to work a cow. And we're going to ask our reigning cow horse cowboys to ride your jumpers. That happens Saturday night in our jumping final two. So we're going to watch BZ, ride a reigning horse. And we're going to watch guys like the same day just try to sail through a jump on one of your jumpers. So, now, hey, guys. Can I just tell you this right now? With all due respect to my show jumping fans, if the dressage fans had a bumper sticker, it would be that dressage fans have more fun. Okay? I remember this from a year ago. So here's what we want to do, just to keep you all together as one audience. We're going to play a song just for the ladies, and just for the ladies. And there's not a woman in this room that doesn't know it, and we expect you to sing along. So let's try this one. Here we go. Louder.
He took the midnight train.
Much better.
Yes, the city boy. Morning rain. He took the midnight train.
Hey, give the ladies a round of applause. That was good. That was good. All right, gentlemen, we're not going to leave you out. We're not going to leave you out but your song is shorter because so is your attention span. Okay? But here's the deal. There's not a man out there who hasn't had that moment of passion with the person the good Lord gave you and hasn't looked at them and said this after that moment of passion. Here we go.
I like it. I love it.
Oh, that was horrible. Really, sir, look, we need all the men. You ready? Here we go, do it again.
I like it, I love it.
There's more women singing that song than there are men. What is that? Well, yeah, okay. All right, here's one that's really, you're all gonna like. Everybody in this room is gonna like this song, so sing it, here we go. You've done it beautifully now, folks. We're going to call on Clint Sylvester to join us in the arena because somebody ought to go home with something for free. Anybody out there want a free t-shirt? If you do, you got to get up and dance for it. That's the problem. We will not throw a team unless you're dancing. Come on. Come on, we'll not throw a team unless you're up and dancing. All right, break it down, Clint. Show them what we wanted to see. These shirts have been signed by all of our riders. If you want one, you got to dance for it. Come on, dressage fans have more fun. Prove it. All right, get rid of what you got, Mr. Sylvester. Throw the ball rail. Excellent. Let her fly! Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are 1 minute away from the next horse entering this pen. Let's turn it back over to Nico Meredith and Miss Charlotte.
Wow, we're having a lot of fun here. I know this announcer is. I know you are too, Charlotte, but we've got to get back underway. The first of the last nine will be coming in.
Yeah, I
need to
catch my breath after all the dancing. And I did not see quite enough dancing out there, I gotta say. We were dancing here. All of you need to do the same the next time. We've got nine to come. Nine to come. The first of those making their way in the ring, representing Russia.
and Romeo Star. A 14-year-old Hanoverian stallion. Romeo Star is under the ownership of Ruby.
So our very next to go is Elena Sidneva and Romeo Star, well-ranked 64, winner of the Central European League this year. Trained at the Russian Olympic Sports Training Center, 13th in the Lyon FEI World Cup Dressage Finals last year. This is the fifth World Cup Finals, including riding at Las Vegas in 2005. Two-time Olympian as well, Elena rode at the Sydney and Athens Olympic Games. So just coming back after quite an exciting break here in the Thomas and Mack Centre, we have the bell for our 10th of 18 to go, Elena Sidneva. So riding Ludmila Dmitrieva's Romeo Star, it is Elena Sidneva for Russia, winner of the Central European League and the third rider for Russia here at the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. So a nice extended trot to start for this combination. I would say to start because it seems like the first movement that comes up, but of course they've already had their movement mark given for the entry, the halt, and coming out of the halt in trot. Good, just look for a little bit more parallel lateral work in the first of those half passes. The second one looks a touch better. Once again there, you see the scores out of 10 coming in from each of the movements from our seven judges arrayed around the arena. In Europe, we're quite used to the five judges. We've got seven here at the final and the judges' supervisory panel as well. Elena scored 75.1 to win the qualifier at Brno on the Central European League. Interesting then at Salzburg, in Austria in December, it was a 71.625 for fourth place. So that's probably what her target is here in freestyle on Saturday. But looking very good here, well over 70% at the moment in Grand Prix as Elena picks up the walk. Good walk, good over-tracking there in the extended walk, settling into their collected walk. Two-time Olympian, rode at the Sydney and Athens Games, Elena. And when she trained at the Russian Olympic Sports Training Center initially, she had to ride dressage because jumping and eventing weren't available to the lady athletes, but has subsequently embraced the sport due to its complexity and the discipline and diligence required from horse and rider. Just looking for a touch more engagement behind in that piaf as we see Elena Sidneva pick up the canter work now. So riding a series of changes, just looking for the balance and obedience of the horse throughout. And they need to show 9 2 tempi changes. Elena moving her body a decent amount in those changes, but getting the job done. Rides the extension. Elena Sidneva, Romeo Star for Russia. change could just have been a touch earlier on the line. So this canter half piece zigzags. The horse just being very fussy about the head and neck in that second beat from right to left. Just bringing in a degree of irregularity to that. Just struggling a little bit for balance in that first pirouette. Yeah, quite quick, just held on that inside hind rather than really, it should march around, it needs to be more marching and less John Travolta. Nice to see them go for this extended trot well in the last time of showing it. So this final center line, and it is so important. Passage, Piaf with the doubling coefficient, the mark for transition, Piaf, Passage, and then the final Passage down to the halt. And the halt itself with its own mark out of 10, it's so easy to throw away marks on the halts. Just powering in this Passage down to the final halt. Stepping into a square halt and salute, it is Elena Sidneva, Romeo Star for Russia. So just looking back to some of the work from Elena Sidneva and Romeo Star here in the Thomas and Mack Center. And that upward transition to counter there, she got that very, very nicely. Watching these two tempi changes as well. A good performance from this combination, Elena Sidneva, Romeo Star. And we stand by for the judges' marks. We just see sometimes a number of badges on riders. Elena just wearing the one badge, and it is the FEI Golden Badge of Honor, and that is for extensive top-level international appearances, and her Olympic appearances and World Championship appearances will have contributed to Elena's right to wear the gold International Equestrian Federation Badge of Honor. The judges at the moment considering the collective marks for the horse's paces, the horse's impulsion, the horse's submission, and the rider then with their own mark out of 10, which is given a doubling coefficient, the last of the collective marks, the rider's position and seat, correctness and effect of the aids all being considered. So score in for Elena Sidneva, Romeo Star, it's 67.014 and takes over ninth position.
M66.9, B67.4, and F is a 67.4. That's going to give them that provisional score of 67.014.
So our leader remains Laura Graves and Verdad for the United States of America, 74.286. And we prepare to welcome forward Michaela Montegunderson with My Lady. Michaela with the Danish warm blood. My Lady. Combination ranked number 42 in the world. And they have an extra starting place in these finals. They compete regularly on the North American League. So
So Michaela has the bell. She is down at the C end of the ring. She needs to get back down to A. Just exchanging a word or two there with the president of the jury today, Francis Verbeek. We saw Michaela last spring at the Rimac FEI World Cup Dressage Finals in Lyon. They finished 11th. They scored 71.4 in freestyle there. And they come to us from Wellington, Florida. Michaela Montegundersen and My Lady are our next to go for Denmark. So Michaela Gundersen did very well. She finished second in one of the Wellington, Florida World Cup qualifiers, practically on home soil for her, 74.075. In the North American League, her average score was 73.962. Now, the way the North American League works, because you've got a lot of shows in the East Coast and the West Coast, and really without flying, never the twain shall meet, they used the two best scores averaged. So 73.9 was Michaela's average score. I say 11th at the Lyon World Cup Finals last year. A combination we also saw at last summer's Alltech FEI World Equestrian Games in Normandy. A lovely shot in there over the marker at B. You just see the change of direction. This second very steep trot half pass just looks a little bit more quality. Just drifting off the boards there, so just lacking straightness in the rein back. Otherwise a very good rein back, but they're just, you know, every single point matters. So transition there into passage for the very first time, very clear transition. Looks in the Piaf in particular like they're really having to work very hard to get anything from this horse. And the horse is being a little bit ungenerous in front in Piaf Passage. Showing a nice softness through the head and neck there in the extended walk. What the judges are looking for is here both a clear difference between the extended and the collection, and conversely a great relationship between the two, because the walk, the underlying walk, should be the same pace. Being very idle in the off four in the Piaf in particular, and just looking very short in the head and neck position. So they pick up their canter. American-based Danish rider Michaela Montegundersen and My Lady. This 15-year-old mare, it's only the second mare we see by Michelino. Nice safe two tempi tour there, the length of the arena, showing their nine. Remember today what is being asked of our riders is to ride a prescribed test, the Grand Prix test. It's the top level prescribed test in the International Equestrian Federation. That is very unfortunate. They're just coming into the change, the horse kicking out behind. Well, at the risk of sounding sexist, you can tell a gelding, but you have to ask a mare. Now, I wonder if without that we would have seen more spread in those zigzags coming further away from the center line. Michaela will be very, very wary about asking each time for these 15-1 tempis, and she's done a very, very good job. Just crabbing a little bit down the center line again. You see that camera is a little bit off the center line, but you could see even on that angle that Frances Verbeek, judging at sea, will have very clearly seen that they were three tracks. Could look for the horse's legs coming a little clearer off the ground, getting a good jump each step around of the canter pirouette. Transitioning it then back to extended trot. And again, every time you sit here and you look at an extension, you go, oh, I could show more. Michaela has made that tactical decision to ride the horse she has on the day and push those throttles as forward as she is comfortable with. And there again, you just see a little bit of tension resulting in a loss of sync there in the Piaf. But I think, you know, particularly showing those 15-2 tempi changes after the change, the single change at the end of the extended canter went so wrong. Michaela Montegundersen has done a superb job here with My Lady, and you can see instantly the contact is taken away. The horse just keen. Oh my goodness, I want to look, I want to understand the arena I'm in. Michaela Montegundersen and My Lady for Denmark finishing their test here. And we stand by for their score. So this is the second of the half passes early on in the test, the trot half passes, and you just saw her change the bend there. This second one, very, very smart. She perhaps lost some of the parallelism, some of the lateral work in the first of those very, very steep trot half passes. But they come so early in the test and they are a very, very high level movement. And it looks really easy to just make your horse go sideways across the arena, but they are just asking a lot of the horse. Now here is the single change at the end of the extension. Yeah, just as Michaela asks, the mare goes, nope, nope, I don't want you to ask me that way today. I want you to ask me in a different, softer way. But as I said, then came in and delivered a 15 single tempi line that was scoring up to 7.5 from some of the judges. So, score in for Michaela Montegundersen and My Lady. It's 70.414. She cracks 70% here today in Grand Prix and takes sixth place at the moment. Huge response here in the Thomas and Mack for our next to go. It's the defending champion. But let's catch up with those results at the moment. Laura Graves still leads with Verdade for the United States of America, 74.286. Morgan Barbenthorn-Mester second, Paulinda Freiberg in third. So our next to go is the most famous dressage horse and rider combination in the world at the moment, Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegro. The world number one and the defending Remacra FEI World Cup dressage champion. So now in the Thomas and Mack Centre, another entertainment superstar takes centre stage.
the world number one ranked combination, the Remacra FEI World Cup dressage defending champions, Britain's Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegro. Owned by Anne Barr, Rolly Luard and Carl Hester. Charlotte holds the Grand Prix world record of 87.46%. And it's her own world record that she broke, the third time she's broken the Grand Prix one. And that was at the London International Horse Show at Olympia in December. She's required as defending champion to make two starts. She made them at London in December and Amsterdam in January and won both of them hands down. She won team and individual gold at London 2012, special and freestyle gold at last summer's World Equestrian Games. Just seeing a real step up, you know, in terms of the horse's self-carriage. Lovely quiet halt. Look at that, already a 10 in there from one of the judges that I've happened to see on the monitor. And 10 doesn't mean perfect, remember, it's simply excellent. The 2013 Remacra Best Athlete Award winner and a solidarity ambassador for the International Equestrian Federation. Great, great Piaf. Charlotte just giving the energy there, just losing some, well, a touch of hesitation just coming out of it. Charlotte just stepping in with the aids to bring it back up. Great rhythm to this walk. Charlotte gathers up the contact, ready for her collected walk. Remember, our leading score at the moment, 74.286 for Laura Graves. World record score, Charlotte's own world record, 87.46. So we're halfway between those two. So starts the Piaf early, just overcooks it a tiny bit. But actually that slight moment when Charlotte perhaps over-aided at the beginning of the Piaf is the expression in the passage. Charlotte's Grand Prix Freestyle world record, 93.975%. And they are, as a pair, a true phenomenon, jumping through and forward in each of these changes. And again, another rider just reaching forward and giving the horse a little pat of reassurance and congratulations. And thanks. Of course, it is a partnership. Charlotte Dujardin, Vallegro, the world number one ranked combination for Great Britain, the Olympic and world champions. Perfectly placed in the arena, and that's a lot of the battle as well, just, you know, going the right amount either side of the center line, starting at the right point, finishing at the right point. And Charlotte did all that as well as riding excellent half passes. Super 110 piece. So now we look in for the Vallegro Masterclass of Canter Pirouette.
three tens there on the 110 piece. And watch again for the way Vallegra just transfers the weight back to the hindquarters in the canter pirouette. Really sits, but jumps and keeps the canter. You know, it's like your lottery numbers coming up twice to see two canter pirouettes like that in a row. If you got one of them, you'd be happy with that. But Charlotte knows she can go with this horse out and ride two canter pirouettes in a row like that every time. And she broke the Grand Prix world record at Olympia on what she called a quiet warm-up round. I don't think she's going to break a world record here today, but she's got a real opportunity to creep up the marks because she's got some of this horse's highlights here on the final centre line, Passage and Piaf. And it's such a valuable final centre line in terms of points. This Piaf has a doubling coefficient. There's the transition mark as well. There's the separate mark also for the halt. And if she can come into a nice, clean, square halt with the horse's weight evenly balanced over all four legs. And that is what great dressage looks like. A super, super Grand Prix for Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegra. They have really set the standard. Can anyone touch them, though? We've got some great competitors to come. We've got Isabel Werth for Germany, Stefan Peters, of course, the last American to win the World Cup finals, and Edward Gall, one of the top names in the sport as well, amongst many others. They're all going to try and take on Charlotte Dujardin, but has she left them clearly in her wake? Just looking back at some of the highlights, they were all highlights. We could show 5 minutes, 45 of highlights of Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegra, but these early half passes, the horse already showing the great self-carriage, the impulsion and submission that's going to serve them so well when it comes to the judging of collective marks. And remember, Vallegra just 13 years old and has achieved so much in this last cycle from those medals at the London 2012 Olympics. These 1-tempi changes scored tens across the boards, and there is the signature Charlotte Dujardin. Salute back to the crowd who she knows support her so, so much.
We move now to
Carl Hester there in the cap. Dickie Waygood, team manager, adding his congratulations.
17-year-old Danish bred mare, Mariette, owned by Marcia Pepper and Lars, representing Denmark now, Lars Peterson and Mariette.
Just standing by for this score for the British Olympic champion. And the defending Remacra FEI World Cup dressage champion, of course. She heads back out into the Nevada sun. The seven judges just finished their deliberation. They're thinking about those collective marks at the moment as well. Paces, impulsion, submission, and the ride. And the bell goes for the next competitor, so I'm afraid we're going to have to keep our powder dry. Lars Peterson and Mariette for Denmark. Score in for Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegra, 85.529. That goes into the lead, of course, here, but plenty of top competitors still to come. This Grand Prix far from over. So Lars Peterson and Mariette for Denmark, ranked 30th in the world at the moment. An Olympian at the Centennial Games in Atlanta in 96. He's also ridden at two World Championships, and with this horse qualified through to the special at last summer's All-Tech FEI World Equestrian Games in Normandy. Lars has represented Denmark at two European Championships where they picked up team bronzes. Now American-based, topped the North American League rankings last year, and this year had the third highest average score on the league, and won two World Cup qualifiers at Wellington, part of the Global Dressage Festival down there in Florida.
based in Loxahatchee, Florida, with his wife, U.S. dressage rider Melissa Taylor. It's so difficult to come in after. I mean, we're just looking at a horse doing so, so well, but nothing like, you know, the self-carriage and just superb training and skills of a horse like Vallegro. With sevens and seven and a halves being well rewarded. Lars finishes his halt and rein back. He's now in this second extension. And picks up the Passage for the first time in the Grand Prix. Starts the Piaf quite early in front of the centre line. And again, just has to urge the horse a couple of times there to pick up and keep the energy in the Piaf. Just very interesting there as we had the shot that also included the trophy. We had the horse's eye. Just see the horse just trying to look out. They are herbivores. They are, you know, animals that are used to being preyed upon. So they look around. They want to see and understand the situation they're in. And it's up to the rider to convey the calmness to them and to give them the confidence to perform. Once again, starting the Piaf early. It's going to just let it creep across the center line. Step by step. And once again, having to work hard to keep the activity in this mare, Mariette, 17-year-old mare by Comeback. Here's in the Danish Warm Blood stud book. So early on in the canter now, this first big question, the two tempi changes. Another one just coming to close to the boards there at H and giving them a wee tap. Oh, again. Well, it shows he's using every inch of the arena. Yeah, just lost the straightness there, protecting the lead, coming into the flying change at the end of the extension. To just losing a little bit of rhythm there, and Lars really threw the hands over to ride that first flying change in the zigzags. Just using a bit of ring craft as well, using a half or an extra stride here and there. Lars's average score in the North American League, remember this is freestyle scores, 76.8. Yeah, unfortunately just crabbing out of this, overturning, and the horse coming down all the canter work there, either side of the flying change at X in, you know, three tracks. Somewhat stuck in that transition as well. The horse swinging a lot behind even on this Passage here. Riding his last Piaf there over the centre line. The imaginary marker X there between B and E. And
switching back up into Passage, coming towards the conclusion of his test. It is Lars Petersen and Mariette for Denmark. So a nice square halt to complete. And a good smile on Lars, as said. Is those mistakes there coming down, particularly in the canter pirouette centre line, they will have cost him dearly. Onto Leonard had been a very secure test. And those who know Lars in particular from Florida were really feeling quite bubbly about it. So just watching some of Lars Petersen's highlights here. Those tempi changes coming to their conclusion. That's the one tempi's going that way towards K. I'm just going to watch some of this canter pirouette line. Now, this is the first of them, and he overturns and has to bring the horse back. There's change that's coming down the line on three tracks now. There he changes as required by the test, but again, the horse then swings the hindquarters to the inside again, coming on three tracks and starts the next pirouette. So they're announcing the score for Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegro. It's 85.529, and of course, they are our leaders. The defending champion takes the lead in the Grand Prix, but this Grand Prix, far from over. Some of the very best names in the world still to come with the opportunity to challenge that score. And very quickly then, Lars Petersen and Mariette score 69.314, and it takes over ninth. But look at the smile on Lars's face when that score comes in. He is happy with what his mare Mariette produced today. Well, one of the top riders on the European circuit, and he's no stranger to Las Vegas either. He was fourth here in the 2009 finals with Nadine. It is Hans-Peter Minderhood with Glocks Flirt. Flirt has been his horse throughout the World Cup season. He rode a horse called Glocks Johnson in the latter half of last year's season to finish eventually fifth at the World Cup finals at Lyon and eventually take that horse Glocks Johnson on to the World Equestrian Games last summer. But it's Glocks Flirt this winter for Hans-Peter Minderhood, Swiss bred horse by Floristan. Our next to go, Hans-Peter Minderhood and Glocks Flirt for the Netherlands. Fourth in the 2009 Las Vegas World Cup Finals with a horse called Nadine, a lovely mare, and then fifth with a horse called Glocks Johnson at last spring's finals at Lyon. Glocks Flirt and Hans-Peter finished sixth on the Western European League with good results at Odense, Lyon, Amsterdam, Neumünster and Setogenbosch. They were the runners-up at Stockholm and scored in excess of 80% for third at Setogenbosch. Glocks Flirt, this horse by Floristan, 14 years old, very, very leggy horse. Some appears in the Swiss stud book. It's out of a Gauguin de Lully mare. You can really appreciate the moment of suspension in those half passes, in particular in this horse's trot work. Ah, now he's very close to the boards there and tapped it then at the beginning of the rein back. And in some horses, that would just make them go, oh, what's happening here? I don't understand. And bring in resistance that's not actually there. But Glocks Flirt, very, very confident stepping back throughout that. So picking up Passage for the first time. This horse's Passage, it's quite staccato. It's not as smooth as some, but it is very much showing the degree of cadence and elevation of the diagonal pairs that you would be looking for. You know, and a lot of that is to do with the simple mechanics of the horse, its conformation, the way it's put together. and carrying the energy of the Passage through into what is an energetic but also a nice relaxed ground covering extended walk. Hans Peter, part of multiple Dutch team performances, including World Team Gold at the Alltech FEI World Equestrian Games in Kentucky in 2010. Yeah, some eights coming in there for the extended walk, as you'd expect. Just that zoomed in shot showed the front legs of that horse in the Piaf, both not only not moving forward as much as we've seen with some of the others, but also stock square, as you'd expect in a halt, under the horse's shoulder. So really good. Difficult to compare the quality of Clock's Flirt's changes with those of Allegro, but he gets the nine in. He ends up quite close to the boards in the last of the nine. Very nice transition and change just before K on the diagonal, coming into the Kenter half pass zigzag sequence. Hans-Peter Minderhood, Clock's Flirt for the Netherlands. Hans-Peter prepares to ride his 15-1 tempiece. He started them quite late, but they finished quite early, so perhaps overall, in a perfect world, Hans-Peter and Clock's Flirt could just throw caution to the wind a little bit more, open out those changes, and cover the distance on the long diagonal. But nobody would turn down 3/8 and a mixed bag of 7s and 7.5s. Just underlining the solid quality of this work. Just as I say, just losing a little bit of quality in that second one. Could have just jumped a little bit more off the ground a couple of times. Hans-Peter is still just toying with Laura Graves, the score. She's in the clubhouse on 74.286. He's trending at 74.6, and of course, collectives to come. So potentially, we're looking at the combination who will take over second place here as they come onto their final center line. Just swinging a little bit side to side. I mean, we remember Nadine, his great mare, did that to a great extent. But Hans-Peter Minderhood coming through his final passage to finish the Grand Prix, the first of two tests that are part of this Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. That was Hans-Peter Minderhood, Clock's Flirt for the Netherlands. Indeed, just at the beginning of that shot, we can see the horse tap the boards. Hans-Peter, another one, just riding every inch of the field of play inside the boards, picking up this canter work. All the work there
being well rewarded. Stephen Clark, the judge there, we can see in the background of that shot. Stephen judging at E. And this is the start of the canter, half past zigzags. Again, Hans Peter turning in a super performance throughout his test. Wim Ernest there, the team manager and trainer for the Dutch. On the right of that shot, just having a little bit of a hot debrief with Hans Peter. And the score is in for Hans-Peter Minderhood and Lox Flirt, and it takes over fourth on 73.714. Well, that's a provisional score at the moment. Just to say, I'm a little bit surprised by that. It would be interesting to see that coming in and confirmed. But there is the last US winner of the FEI World Cup Dressage Finals in this arena in 2009, Stefan Peters. Stefan won then with Ravel. Today he rides Legolas. He's coming up just shortly. Our next to go, two-time FEI World Cup champion, Isabel Wirth. Isabel rides El Santo, a horse with which she is ranked number 19 in the world. She finished third on the Western European League, rode Don Johnson and El Santo this year. El Santo's best result was second at Gothenburg. One of Isabel's two World Cup wins came here at Las Vegas in 2007. Last year with El Santo, she was fifth at the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals at Lyon in France. She's one of the most successful equestrians of all time. She's won five Olympic golds, including the individual title at the Centennial Games in Atlanta in 96, seven world golds, including three individual titles, seven European golds, including four individual titles. This is a European Championships year, of course, for us across the pond. And they are on home soil for Isabel in Aachen. Interesting to see as the outdoor season gets going whether we'll see Bella Rose come out, the horse that took the world by storm at the World Equestrian Games last summer. Strong scores early on for Isabel Wirth. Rides another good extended trot. You can see her pushing and asking for the reach and transitions to Passage. Just trying to create the energy and containers in front here with El Santo. Rhinelander owned jointly by Isabel together with her long-term patron, Madeline Winterschulz. Extended walk, perhaps bordering a touch on free walk, but Isabel and El Santo score well, up as high as 8.5. And no question at all that the first step in that transition was a Passage step. The Passage just compresses a little bit as she turns the corner into the ring, and those front legs coming right in underneath. Isabel's having to work hard to keep the energy in this, keep the pace going. Works nice and uphill, it's good quality. She
she starts her two tempi changes. Very top competitors in the world, and what she's aiming to do today, the Grand Prix helps set the conditions for the starting order for the freestyle. The freestyle contributes 100% to the result of the finals. This sets the starting order. Why is that important? Isabel wants to be in the last five, so she needs to finish in the top five today. That means she'll be up against Vallejo, she'll be up against Edward Gal, up against Stefan Peters, perhaps Laura Graves. If you're in that judging block, the judges are switched on to looking for top dressage, and that's why you want to be in it. You want to get all those marks. And Isabel, she's very good technically. She's going to get a good score, but she's not going to win this class. She might not even overtake Laura Graves. But when you put her ability artistically together with what her horses do technically, then you've got a fire on your hands, because she is superb. And if she can be in that final five, she can bring the challenge to the best in the world, no doubt about it. Very nice pirouette there. 15 one-tempies, mix of 7 and 7.5. The second pirouette, perhaps a little scruffier. Just losing a little bit of balance. So transitioning back out of canter work. Great to have a couple of angles on that extended trot to just show how much Isabel goes for it. On the right-hand side of the Kiss and Cry there in the blue is Madeline Winterschulz, the owner of this horse, together with the German team structure, including team trainer Monica Theodorescu. So on their final center line, two-time FEI World Cup champion and a former winner here in Las Vegas to boot, with the 14-year-old El Santo NRW. It is one of the greatest equestrians of all time, Isabel Werf for Germany. So, enjoying some of the highlights from this test. These are the two tempi changes which come early in the canter work. It's all very secure, and as I said, it's a lovely quality of canter from El Santo. Sometimes Isabel's horses can be a little bit spooky, particularly Don Johnson. We didn't see any of that today, but I tell you, if something goes wrong in a test, you want Isabel Werf on your horse, because she never looks back. She always looks forward and approaches each new test straight out of the box. She never reflects back on a past disappointment, but always looks to the future and rides for that future. Here's this first canter pirouette, which was so strong. Unfortunately, let down a little bit by the second one on the same center line. We said that with Vallejo, to get two in a row, bang on, in your Grand Prix test is a dream come true.
Just three rides remaining. Two of our riders in the World Cup Finals from the United States joining us now, the second rider representing the United States here, Stefan Peters and Legolas. Legolas, a 13-year-old Westman gelding owned by the Four Winds Farm.
So I think once again we're just going to have Isabel's score held. So at the moment, 85.529 leads for Charlotte Dujardin for Great Britain. Now, America's top dressage rider, one of the most familiar names around the world, flying the flag for American dressage, Stefan Peters.
Isabel Wirth, El Santo, NRW score 72.843, and that puts them into fifth place at the moment. So we're back to the action with Stefan Peters and Legolas for the United States of America. Ranked just outside the top 10 in the world at the moment, qualifiers, of course, from the North American League. They had the leading average score of 80.875%. West Coast-based, Californian now, Stefan Peters, of course, originally born and raised in Germany, and he brings all that German training and experience to bear. He won Olympic team bronze at Atlanta in 96, team and individual gold at the 2011 Pan American Games in Guadalajara in Mexico, and won the special and freestyle bronze medal with Ravel at the World Championships in Kentucky in 2010. And won the last World Cup finals that were held here in Las Vegas with Ravel in 2009. Legolas won the Burbank and San Juan Capistrano World Cup qualifiers out there on the West Coast, and was 10th in the freestyle at last summer's World Championships in Normandy. Legolas, 13 years old, by Laumerden, out of a Floristan mare. Nice rein back, very positive steps backward. Watch this first transition into Passage. Regularly reported as a Piaf Passage machine, this horse, Legolas. So this should be a real highlight. And if the first Passage is anything to go by, it really is. Great quality and consistency in the diagonal pairs in this Piaf Passage work. Stefan Peters now picks up the walk. It's not the biggest walk we've seen, but the horse is presenting a very nice, relaxed outline. So the 10 marks available for that transition at M. Looking good for Stefan Peters. And just a little bit of tension this time in the Piaf. It's not as secure, it's not as tidy. Picks the upward transition to canter. A tiny bit underwhelming, the quality of this canter. And you know, with a bigger, more powerful canter, you'd have seen those changes come closer up to the H marker. Still trending very well. I mean, again, regular commentators here in America would say that the canter is perhaps Legolas's weakest pace. But then you put a rider of the caliber of Stefan Peters aboard, and he will eke out every single mark. And again, all of the canter work just could benefit from a little bit more energy and expression. And again, we saw a slightly constrained canter half-pass zigzag sequence from Stefan in comparison to one or two of the ones we've seen at the World Cup level. Turning in his 15 changes. Again, sometimes a tricky movement for this horse. The canter work not bringing in massive scores, but not throwing lots of scores away either. So with good Piaf Passage scores, this 76.3 that we're seeing on the screen at the moment seems achievable. So final extended trot. So is it the battle of the stars and stripes here? Is Stefan Peters going to overtake Laura Graves for second place as things stand at the moment here in the Thomas and Mack Centre? He's on his final centre line and all is looking good. And of course, at the end of the test, the judges will consider those collective marks for the horse's paces. Now again, could be marked down a little bit because of the canter, its impulsion, its submission and the rider. Well, the rider is Stefan Peters, so that should be good marks. Out of Piaf, coming on to his final centre line. 2010 World Bronze Medalist, Pan Am Gold Medalist. Stefan Peters here, the 2009 FEI World Cup champion, finishes his Grand Prix with Legolas. Well, a good test from Stefan Peters. But there are two more to come who could easily overtake him. Edward Gaut, Jessica von Breda-Vandel. This is far from over. This Grand Prix is going to go right down to the wire, and it might be for second place behind Charlotte Dujardin. But they all want to get into that final five. That's what matters. So I look back at Stefan Peters. This is the first Passage Piaf, and this is when all eyes in the arena just came down to this horse and went, wow. A horse that if he could get all the elements together would be right up there competing. But here the Piaf Passage is competitive. It is so competitive. It is so strong. And the Grand Prix test, therefore, plays to this horse's advantage. Now, in writing his freestyle program, there's no doubt that Stefan Peters is going to do as much Piaf Passage as he can and increase the degree of difficulty within those paces as well. The canter work, as I say, a little bit underwhelming, but he turned in everything. He was getting 7.5s probably for everything he did in canter. So he wasn't losing marks over his average and, therefore, you know, a very, very strong test. Stefan Peters, Legolas, it's 76.871. And that goes into second place. Stefan Peters, 76.871 into second, just overtaking Laura Graves now for the United States of America, who holds third. But out in front, the world number one, Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegro. Two more to come here, and two more who could absolutely feature in the top five of this Grand Prix today.
It's getting more and more exciting.
So, Great Britain holding the lead, the West Coast holding second, the East Coast holding third. The FEI steward there just doing the tack and bidding check. It's conducted after the test to ensure that it doesn't affect the horse's performance. And if you were wondering, Stefan Peters and Legolas, it is confirmed. Second place, 76.871. Edward Gaut locks undercover.
The suffix there, NOP, meaning the horse has been given support by the Dutch Equestrian Federation to stay in Dutch ownership going forward to the next Olympic cycle. Edward was the winner of the Western European League. He just pipped Jessica von Brede-Vandel with his result from Sertogenbosch. Undercover won at Odense and was second at London Olympia to Villegro. Team bronze at the World Equestrian Games last year for Edward when he was riding Glock's Voice, the horse he rode at the Gothenburg World Cup qualifier. Edward Gaal, Glock's undercover now for the Netherlands. London Olympics combination. The combination have been on the podium at the last two World Cup finals, Gothenburg and Lyon. Edward won the 2010 World Cup finals and he was second here at Las Vegas in 2005 with Ling. Winner of the Western European League with 75 points off good results. He only had four starts on the league. You need four scores. Very, very elegant presentation. You know, not the usual way we're used to seeing extended trot, but when we think back to Totalus, very, very similar. So team bronze and individually ninth in the freestyle at the London Olympic Games when they were quite a new combination together. And their freestyle, they were probably only riding it for the second time at London. So very, very early days, but we are trending in excess of 80%. You know, Edward is going the right way about standing on a World Cup podium again with Glock's undercover. Extended trots, they look very good, but they're perhaps, you know, overall a little bit contained. Sitting right down on the hindquarters there in the Piaf. The one detriment in Piaf Passage of having a horse that is so good behind is that you go brilliant behind, your eye immediately switches to the front, and in this case you are a tiny, tiny bit disappointed. You're not the best and most ground covering of walks in that extended walk section, transitions to collected walk along the short side. Again, it just feels like it's not really going anywhere. It's lacking a bit of energy and struggling there with that transition, which is a shame. I'm thinking back to the walk, which, you know, all just looked that little bit constrained, and that it will come back to the collectives as well when the judges think about the walk as part of their paces mark. But back again, we've got Piaf Passage going very well for Glock's undercover and Edward Gaal for the Netherlands. Perhaps say about this horse is he is quite a hot horse, and if anything in the arena was going to distract him. This is perhaps the horse it would happen to, and we've seen it there in those two important transitions coming into Passage from the Walk and there at the beginning of the canter as well. Not the cleanest upward transition. Edward riding these two tempies carefully over towards the cup in the corner. Very correct in the positioning of that change, and of course the change itself at the end of the extension for Edward. Edward Gaal locks under cover for the Netherlands. Edward, one of four former World Cup champions in our field here at Las Vegas. Nice and well-ridden canter zigzag. Now, he just didn't come as cleanly out of that corner, and Edward just using a stride or two to set the horse up, and now he perhaps doesn't have the room to let the horse go forward on the 15-1 tempies as he normally would. You can see our trend is dipped below 80% as well. We're on 78%. It would still be good enough for second place in front of Stefan Peters. But I think Edward would have liked to have finished the day over 80%. This horse scored 88% in freestyle at Odense in Denmark. Change maybe not quite so straight. Wonderful second pirouette. So onto this final centre line. Piaf Passage playing to this horse's strengths. And he's pretty good across the board. I think it was the walk really that's going to have held him back the most. You can hear the shutters of the cameras completely in sequence with the diagonal pairs. So working his way to the conclusion of his test, our penultimate combination here, and one who could absolutely feature in the final shakeup. It is the Dutch rider, Edward Gaal, and Glocks undercover. Well, a very well-ridden test there. Edward using all of his experience to just turn one or two things that might have been going a tiny bit wrong back in his favour. So here's some of the highlights of Eddie's test with Glocks on the cover. This is the first trot half pass we saw. The transition from half pass right to half pass left. And again, this trot worked really, really nice. The horse in great self-carriage as well, as we've seen several times now as we get towards the very top end of the sport. You know, the draw slightly set up that way to give us the best in the second half of the competition. We've seen the best in the world, Charlotte Dujardin. The question now is how close will anyone come? And these are the canter pirouettes. Edward was lucky enough to have two great canter pirouettes on the centre line. And a wave for the crowd here in the Thomas and Mack Centre from Edward Gaal.
For Germany, Jessica Schwarz.
So 85.529 leads at the moment for Great Britain, the defending champion Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegro. So, score in for Edward Gald, locks undercover for the Netherlands. It's 79.057 and it goes into second place. So just the one over 80% at the moment, and only one more who can try and achieve that, scoring over 80% in Grand Prix. But Edward Gald locks undercover, second at the moment, 79.057. So just starting their test is our last to go here of 18 world-class horse and rider combinations at these World Cup finals. It is Jessica von Breda-Wendel and Yune BB for Germany. Jessica was for a long time the leader of the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Western European League and ended up finishing second. With Yune BB, she is ranked 11th in the world. Another former European young rider, gold medalist, that's our under 21 level in equestrian sports. She was seventh at the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Finals at Lyon. This year, runner-up at Stuttgart, the German Master Show, third at the London International Horse Show at Olympia, third at Amsterdam. Of course, at those two shows, she would have got the points for second place because the winner there was the defending champion, Vallegro, who takes no points. And Jessica then went on to win in Gothenburg on 81.65 in the freestyle. So completing these steep trot half passes. Great square halt, nice and secure. It's so difficult because it's so easy to say it didn't hold the halt for long enough, and then the next thing is you go, well, maybe held the halt for too long. Yeah, it's a real balancing act. So extension and then transition to passage for Yune BB and Jessica von Breda-Wendel. Good solid Piaf. Is it in the quality of one or two others we've seen? Perhaps not. You know, Stefan, Peter's horse Legolas, undercovers, and of course Vallegro. But if Jessica can just keep the standard up across the board, she can be right up there with the leaders in this World Cup finals. Just riding her collected walk, Jessica von Breda-Wendel and Yune BB. With this last rider in the ring scoring well, the situation is that Charlotte Dujardin, the defending champion, the Olympic champion, the world champion, leads here in Las Vegas. Edward Gall, former World Cup champion, second. Stefan Peters, former World Cup champion for the United States of America, is in third. And the American young gun, Laura Graves, is just off the podium at the moment in fourth. Nice transition out of that Piaf for Jessica. Picking up the canter. Oh. So that mistake in the two tempies means we're pretty much guaranteed that our only competitor to score in excess of 80% here today is Charlotte Dujardin. And what does that mean if they're going to be the only person over 80%? Is this World Cup final set? Well, I would still say no, because when we come back on Saturday, we've got the Grand Prix freestyle. Everyone starts again on zero. The freestyle score is the only one that contributes to the final World Cup podium. And it's 50% technical, 50% artistic. And that is where Isabel Wirth, Stefan Peters, Edward Gal, it's where they make their money. They will come up and they will turn in super high quality, high difficulty freestyle floor plans that will absolutely bring the competition to Charlotte Dujardin. And that margin that we see at the moment, roughly 6.5% between Charlotte Dujardin and Edward Gal, that's not going to be the case here on Saturday. Very consistent and nice 15-1 tempies there from Jessica von Brede-Verndl and Yune Bibi, which she'll be pleased with after those problems in the two tempi. Down as low as 5.5 from one of the judges there, the judge at B, Peter Holler of Germany. And that's one of the areas of variation that the judges' supervisory panel will just step in and confirm that they're happy that that is correct judging. And one or two times they've just become a little bit stuck in the transition, that one there at M, and also struggling once or twice to come out of the canter pirouettes as well. Riding their last extension, our last Grand Prix horse and rider combination, Jessica von Brede-Verndl, Yune Bibi for Germany. Just showing the quality of German dressage, that they are one of the nations here represented by the maximum of three riders. And indeed, Sweden and Germany, if I remember rightly, were two of the nations that had more than three riders in the qualification zone of automatic qualifiers from the Remacher FEI World Cup Dressage Western European League. But only a maximum of three per nation can come to the finals. So riding their final passage, one of Germany's most promising young riders, another former European young rider champion alongside countrywoman Fabienne Lütkemeyer. It is Jessica von Brede-Verndl and Yune Bibi bringing our Grand Prix to a thrilling conclusion here in the Thomas and Mack Centre. So, looking back at some of the highlights of Jessica's test, Jessica von Brede-Verndl with Yune Bibi. We saw that huge moment of suspension here in this work. Really is a great example of exactly what we're looking for there in the passage. And then just at the last second there, we had the upward transition to canter. Jessica quite embarrassed, she thought that was her score. Seventy-six point eight four three has Stefan Peters into third. So score in for Jessica von Brede-Verndl and Yune Bibi. It is fourth, 74.871. So the United States of America maintains one on the podium. Stefan Peters will take third in today's Grand Prix based on that provisional score as it stands at the moment for Jessica von Brede-Verndl. Let's have a look at these final results then. Charlotte Dujardin takes the win, Edward Gal second, Stefan Peters third, Jessica von Brede-Verndl fourth, and in fifth place, Laura Grave. They're the all-important top five who will start last in the freestyle final. Not from the United States of America. Give me a round of applause. Looking further down the list there, we've got Fabienne Lütkemeyer for Germany. She's not here with her top horse, takes 11th today in the Grand Prix on 70%. We've got Alneda Kirk-Thingard and Jojo, probably one of the ones most disappointed with their performance today, 67.986. Can they bring it back on Saturday? Elena Sidneva, Romeo Star, Tatiana Dorofeva taking 17th and 18th. They will all ride on Saturday in the freestyle. But this Grand Prix will set the conditions for the starting order only. Nothing else about the Grand Prix affects the REMACRA FEI World Cup dressage result. So here, a recap of our top three, looking at the tempi changes in Canter for Stefan Peters and Legolas for the United States of America. Representing the West Coast here at the REMACRA FEI World Cup dressage finals, this horse and rider combination had Piaf Passage out of this world. Super, super from them. Maybe just let down a little bit by the horse's canter work, but Stefan rode for every point he possibly could and helped steer this pair into third. One former World Cup winner. In second place, another former World Cup winner. Edward Gaal, Glocks undercover for the Netherlands. Just missed out on an 80% score. He had superb canter pirouettes there on the center line, and Edward, no stranger to success here in Las Vegas. But making her first visit to Las Vegas and riding in only her second FEI World Cup dressage finals. It is the defending REMACRA champion, Charlotte Dujardin, and the wonder horse, Vallegro. Olympic, European, and world championship titles. They already hold the World Cup. Can they retain it here in the Thomas & Mack Center in Las Vegas, Nevada?
You're not familiar. Your job is to cut a cow from the herd and keep the cow from getting back to the herd. So
a little bit of a fun feel of the American West here. While we set up for the presentation of awards, we've got a little bit of cutting and rodeo here in the Thomas & Mack Center field of play.
As a matter of fact, some of your jumpers will actually compete on a live cow on Saturday night. But your job is to make your horse see it, make your horse turn it, and make your horse box it. Now the rodeo cowboy comes out. Here you have to brand your calf, you have to doctor your calf, so somebody's got to catch and tie your calf. Oh, hey, guess what? Have you ever watched the Dallas Cowboys? Tony Romo misses a lot, okay?
So, now, there you go. That's right, that happens. That's just called being a cowboy, folks.
Some of these reining horse demonstrations. Notice how the animal handles gunfire. That's right. Not only while he's spinning to the left, but while he's spinning to the right. Check this out. That's being a cowboy, Wild West style. Giddy up. Now watch this. You talk about trust between horse and rider. You see it a lot in dressage. Can you lay one of them down like that?
Yeah.
Heads up. The horse never bobbles. And now you will see the love from Bobby as he reaches down past the horse, asking to sit up and stand up. What do you say, Las Vegas? What do you think of him so far? Thank you. Now, if this doesn't get your attention, nothing will. You know, even today, when you're going from show to show, or rodeo to rodeo, sometimes you just like to have your best friend in the seat right beside you.
Black Bull, Texas tea. Well, the first thing you know, though, Jed's a millionaire. The kinfolk said, Jed, move away from there. Said, California is a
place. You bet. This is something you can record if you want to record it. Get your cameras out. Take this memory home with you. But while you're doing that, why don't you put your hands together for Bobby Kerr?
the million-dollar Mustang makeover champion. And we can't just applaud for Bobby. How about it for that eight-year-old Mustang named Poncho?
Well, now it's time to say goodbye to Jeff and all his kin. We would like to thank you for coming.
So how do y'all enjoy that? Well, we'll have you know that throughout the course of the FEI World Cup, whether it's show jumping or dressage, we will have all kinds of things for you just like that. But right now...
So Bobby Kerr there, winner of the million-dollar Mustang makeover, amongst many other things. Yeah, but that is a fascinating competition, that million-dollar Mustang makeover. So, Charlotte Dujardin, Edward Gall, Stefan Peters are our top three for Great Britain, the Netherlands and the United States of America. It's set to be a great finals on Saturday. So, Charlotte Dujardin, our winner, Edward Gall in second, Stefan Peters in third, Jessica von Bredow-Werndl, our last to go, slotted in fourth, and then Laura Graves, individually fifth at the World Championships, takes fifth. Sixth, Painted Black, Morgan Barbenson-Mestre, Hans-Peter Minderhood, Lox Flirt, seventh. In eighth, Isabel Wirth, El Santo. Ninth, Paulinda Freiberg. Tenth, Inessa Merkelova. 11th, Fabienne Lutkemeyer. 12th, Michaela Munter-Gundersen. 13th, Terry Steggers. 14th, Lars Pedersen. 15th, Marlon Hamilton. 16th, Alneda Kirk-Thingard. 17th, Tatiana Dorofeva. And 18th, Elena Sidleva for Russia.
Hey, you two, are you in love? There you go. No, it's got to be lip to lip. There you go. How about you? We're looking for a little more love out there. How about some young love? Oh, wait. That was a peck. That was
yes.
A kiss.
Yes.
Just getting these pictures from behind the scenes down in the warm-up as they wait for the presentation of awards here. Edward Gall having a chat to Charlotte Dujardin.
Please help me. What? Sir, did you come with your sister? Be honest. It's your brother's wife, I'm guessing here. I don't. Somebody needs to kiss. I can tell you that. Wake him up. There you go. You're gonna kiss me. Whoa! You see what I mean? Dressage fans have more fun. Come on, Grandpa, just because they're still on the roof, don't mean it. Whoa!
Nice to see you.
Hey, you got some splaining to do there, cowboy. Oh, hey, give yourselves a round of applause for being so much fun with us today. You're an awesome audience. Awesome. Yeah, you're doing way too much speaking about it, I can tell you that. So now, my friends, it's time for your round of honor. And we'll begin with the number 8.
So we're just about to start the presentation of awards, and coming forward to take their bow to the Thomas and Mack audience first is going to be eighth place competitor, former World Cup champion, two-time World Cup champion, including here in Las Vegas, Isabel Wirth with El Santo. Isabel finished on a score of 72.843.
Riding for the Netherlands. On a horse called Glass Flirt.
This is coming into the ring now, seventh position for this man, Hans-Peter Minderhood and Glass Flirt. Hans-Peter finished on an eventual score of 73.657.
She will be on foot. It is the youngest rider here at the age of 23.
Well, Morgan Barbenson-Mestre enters the arena on foot, Painted Black, usually excused presentations of awards. Morgan often, if she hasn't at the show, rides one of her younger horses for the awards. The 18-year-old Painted Black can't be trusted. Morgan Barbenson-Mestre, sixth here today for Spain on 73.786. And there's a round of applause for Laura Graves and Verdade for the United States of America. 74.286 for the Florida rider. Laura Graves ranked 10th in the world. Our last to go of 18 in a world-class field, slotted into fourth. Jessica von Bredow-Vandal and Yune Bibi for Germany, scoring 74.843. That's our eighth to fourth. We'll let them take their lap of honour here in the main arena at the Thomas and Mack Center at this REMACRA FEI World Cup Dressage Finals. And in a moment, we'll welcome in our top three. One for the United States of America, one for the Netherlands, and a win here today for Great Britain. Coming down the chute, there are our top three. And we just see Jessica and Laura. Laura just exchanging a little bit of a fist bump there with Stefan Peters. East Coast versus West Coast, I'm sure there's a little competition there as well.
They're making their way down the ramp at this time.
Edward and Charlotte there, following along behind.
In the number three spot, about to make his way in the ring. Riding for the United States of America on a horse named Legolas. It is.
So coming into the arena, it is our third place competitor, ranked just outside the world's top 10. Former winner of the World Cup Finals when they were held here in Las Vegas. It is Legolas and Stefan Peters, third on a score of 76.843. In second place, another former World Cup champion. Here riding Glocks undercover NOP, it is for the Netherlands, Edward Gaal.
With an amazing score in the mid-80s.
And with a score of 85.414, the winner here today was the Olympic, European and World Champion, the defending World Cup Champion, the world number one combination, Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegro for Great Britain.
We will now bring in the flame of Great Britain, and an honor, Charlotte and Vallegro, with the national anthem of Great Britain.
We're delighted to welcome FEI Bureau member and chair of the Dressage Technical Committee, Mr. Frank Kemperman, and Tim Keener, event director here on behalf of Las Vegas Events, representing the organizing committee.
And the vice president of Las Vegas Events, Mr. Tim Keener, to make the presentations to our chair.
So Frank Kemperman steps forward to congratulate Charlotte Dujardin. Frank representing the International Equestrian Federation. He's the chairman of the Technical Committee for Dressage and is a Bureau member.
is Frances Verbeek.
Frances Verbeek van Rui, our judge today at sea, adding her congratulations on behalf of the seven-member judges panel here at Las Vegas. And now Tim Keener, event director here at Las Vegas Events and vice president of Las Vegas Events, congratulates on behalf of the organizing committee our winner, Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegro.
And now it's time for our champion and our second and third place finishers to make their victory gallop around this arena, and all of you will have the opportunity to let them know how impressed you are with their performances on this Thursday matinee, the Grand Prix of Dressage. Leading the way, of course, will be Charlotte Dujardin of Great Britain on the
Lego. So it is time for the lap of honor. We congratulate our top three. In third place, Stefan Peters and Legolas. In second place, Edward Gald locks undercover. But the winner here today of the Grand Prix on 85.414%, the British defending Remacra champion, Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegro. Four defending champions in the field. Isabel Wirth a little bit further down. She, in fact, won one of her championships here in Las Vegas. But this top three, all World Cup champions in previous editions. Quality will always rise, and it's done here to so here today.
We'll ask Miss Charlotte to stay with us and make one more lap by herself.
But great to have Stefan Peters right there in touch. Edward Gall, who's done very well here in Las Vegas in the past as well. Second with Lynn, but now on her own, Charlotte Dujardin and Vallegro for Great Britain, the defending champions, the world number one, the only score in excess of 80% in Grand Prix today. You'd have to say this is their World Cup finals to lose. There's a little bit more Vegas style. A huge round of applause and support there for Charlotte Dujardin as she leaves the arena. So, ladies and gentlemen, we hope you enjoyed our coverage today of the Remacra FEI World Cup Dressage Grand Prix. Don't forget to join us as all 18 come back for the freestyle on Saturday here at the Thomas & Mack Centre at 11:50 local time.
We're so